Hi, this is Michael Buffer, and you're listening to the voice of the people. Let's get ready for Boxing Voice.
Welcome to ThaBoxingvoice.com official boxing radio show. Our radio show will provide in-depth international coverage of the sport of boxing. You'll receive your daily boxing news and headlines, as well as pre-fight previews on upcoming fights, along with a detailed review of every fight, the aftermath, and its results. Our audience is second to none with callers from all over the world. The difference between us and most is our continued effort to prioritize the boxing fans, putting them first, giving them the platform to express their angers and celebrations when they pick the winner correctly or incorrectly. Call in and voice your opinion here on the Voice of the People hotline, 646-478-3068. Make sure you follow us on YouTube and Blog Talk Radio to receive one email whenever a show is scheduled, because we do spontaneous shows you wouldn't want to miss. Follow us on all social networks at The Boxing Voice.
All right, all right, all right. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of The Boxing Voice. Today is Sunday, September 27th. And this is your Juan Francisco Estrada and Deontay Wilder review, both on PBC and beIN Sports, and a bunch of other fights, you know, we got to talk about. Obviously, we're going to get into some news and notes, and we're going to serve some people a little bit of crow. So, you know, without further ado, let me get into some of these guys here that are ready to talk some boxing.
Introducing the hard-hitting ringside, Robbie.
Well, good PBC fights this weekend, especially with Wilder and company. We'll get into that later, and it's too bad that the Klitschko-Fury fight has been called off.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people are definitely upset about that, man. Hopefully they can, you know, come to some sort of agreement. Maybe Klitschko's calf doesn't hurt anymore. I don't know, man. I don't get the whole calf injury. But Christopher Bobie, I don't know how many times we're gonna ask you to email us your address to send you this this glove, brother. We're trying here. Show after show, we're trying. Speaking of show after show, we do have to remind you guys about these Gennady Golovkin, David Lemieux tickets. Remember, all you got to do is head on over to theboxingvoice.com and subscribe to our email list and receive two free tickets to Gennady Golovkin, David Lemieux live October 17th, Saturday in New York City at Madison Square Garden. So, you know, head on over to theboxingvoice.com and subscribe to our email list, and then, you know, you can have a opportunity to win those tickets. And everyone who's dropped us an iTunes review, thank you so much. And
remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
But only if you feel we deserve a 5-star review. Obviously, if you're listening on YouTube, remember to like, share, and comment. Join in our chat there, even though there's a bunch of, you know, very, very weird people. But now that we got everybody here, let's get into them.
It's me, Mario.
Mario, we cannot hear you, buddy. But in the meantime,
you want the title shot at the beat. You're not even running, and you want the title shot at the beat.
Welcome, everybody, to another edition of a great show that we have planned out for you. Tons of fights. We're gonna get into it, man. We're gonna get into it.
Go ahead, Enrique. Go ahead, jump
in. What's up, man?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I just want to say I saw the fight, too.
Just stay focused. Stay working my jab and using my fundamentals. Passion fan, right? Boxing voice.
Because if you come to fight, then I'm going to have to look for him,
right? Passion fan, right? Boxing voice.
Exactly.
Yo, what's up? So I hope you hear me. You hear me loud and clear? I'm so happy in my intro it says I saw the fight, too. I saw 3 fights this weekend. They were great. 2 out of the 3 fights I give 2 thumbs up to. And, you know, the Dominique Brazil and the Andy Ruiz fight, as well as Deontay Wilder. So I'm curious to see how people gauge those fights. And I got my 2 cents I want to put in, too. So what's up, and welcome back.
It's me, Mario.
Difficulties. And I will say that I am going to make a point to talk about Estrada Marquez as much as possible, all day, the entire show. Estrada Marquez, Estrada Chocolatito. That's what it's all about. The Mayweather Pacquiao of 2016.
You know, it's funny you say that, man, because I see a lot of you guys out there, and you're so big on this division. And I watched the Estrada fight, and I don't know if it's because subconsciously I know that they're small. They don't look small on TV at all, so I'm not using that as an excuse. I'm asking for help as to why I don't care as much as I do with other divisions, as to why while watching Estrada Marquez, which was all action, you know, it had maybe over 5 knockdowns, right?
7.
Look at that. Jesus. You know, so, I mean, I just don't know. Why am I drawn to my Twitter timeline instead of on the screen? And I don't know, you know. But I will say I do see the skill in Estrada, even though he got hit. But, I mean, Marquez at one point was, you know, considered a top-tier fighter. He gave up a good fight. Like I said, there was, you know, 7 knockdowns, all Estrada knocking down Marquez, obviously. But it was a good back-and-forth fight for as long as that lasted. Then Estrada really took over. I didn't score it round by round because I knew that this was a showcase for Estrada. But again, he didn't do much to bring me in and have me as excited as you are to see Chocolatico and him.
You know, you said it perfectly. We knew what to expect from this fight. Marquez is a guy who, even at 27 years old, people called old and seasoned. And I was one of those guys. I made a joke on Twitter last night saying, who said this guy was old? Because in the first couple of rounds, he seemed like he was competing. And he had a bounce in his step. But there were some issues, obviously, and his age did catch up to him. So we knew what it was going to be. But we also knew it was going to be a war at times. And it was. It was absolutely incredible action. It was never dull. These guys are fast. They're strong for small guys. And you're absolutely right. They don't look as small on TV. You know, they're much, much smaller. I'm 5'6", and I've got multiple inches on all these guys in this division. But they're just so much fun. And they produce this kind of offense that cannot be generated in any other form or fashion in any other division. The featherweights, in my opinion, are like the heavyweights of the smaller divisions. The flyweights are like the welterweights. They give you a little bit of everything, and they're so dynamic. They have the ability to showcase top-notch skill sets, but at the same time, they have the action and the heart to produce unforgettable moments. How many of you thought Marquez was done after that first and second knockdown? Because I did, and he willed himself. Now, he didn't will himself back into the fight from a competitive standpoint, but he absolutely remained in the fight in the sense that he was never giving up. I promise you can only count on your hand maybe a few guys that are in Marquez's, I guess, like position in terms of being old but not that old, seasoned, and having gone through so many wars, that would have survived the way he did. But Estrada's got this ability, and we had some debates on Twitter last night about how far Estrada's come since the loss to Chocolatito. I believe he is he's gotten as good as he can get. He's better. For anyone that says he's not, they're fooling themselves. He's much better than he was against Chocolatito in the first fight. That's what makes this fight compelling. I think Chocolatito's the favorite. I think he wins, but it's going to be action, and that's what you get from these fights. Look at the Wilder fight, which I know we're going to get into next. The Wilder fight was, it was supposed to be a blowout, right? You had a huge favorite, and was it action? You know, at times, I guess, but the difference between this is that Estrada and Marquez produced exciting fight all the way through.
Oh, well,
go ahead, Robbie.
Okay. I didn't want to step on anybody. Mario, one of the problems this division has, though, I mean, people like you talking about it makes it sound wonderful, but the TV networks have never taken these lower divisions seriously. I mean, the last time I can remember a top-notch fight was all the way back when Michael Carvajal fought Chiquita Gonzalez. I mean, because HBO started their Boxing After Dark series showing these little guys. Somebody's going to have to put the spotlight on these guys so people who are real boxing fans can start paying attention to these smaller divisions. I think that's why some of these smaller guys get overlooked.
Yeah, absolutely. You're 100% on the dot. But the last thing I'll say about it is that Chocolatito and Estrada represents the biggest fight in boxing that I think can be made from a pure excitement standpoint. It doesn't matter if you're not interested in them now. When it comes to the fight, you will be your entire attention will be captured, and it'll be what happens in the ring that speaks for the fight, which is the best kind of fights to produce.
Yeah, I want you guys to remember to use that hashtag TBV podcast when wanting to conversate about the show. Remember the number 646-478-3068. Press 1 if you haven't done so already, if you want to talk to the panelists. So let's get right into it. Obviously, we didn't give the facts of beIN Sports. Juan Francisco Estrada defeated Hernan Tyson Marquez by 10th round KO for Estrada's WBA and WBO flyweight title. So Estrada retains his title and basically opens up an opportunity for maybe some Chocolatito. Now, he has to take care of his business on the Gennady Golovkin pay-per-view with David Lemieux October 17th, and then maybe we'll see these two guys back in action for what is a rematch, right? Because they already fought. So let's head on over to Unimas and talk about a little bit about Andy Ruiz. This will be quick. Andy Ruiz, man, I mean, it was an 8-round unanimous decision in the heavyweight division. You know, I'm not going to knock on this guy too much because he lost a significant amount of weight. He looked good, and he did what he had to, but he was in there with Joel Godfrey, who lost by 8-round unanimous decision, and he didn't really offer much of anything. I mean, you know, I can't use the word literally when I tell you he didn't throw punches, because obviously he did throw some, but I wish I had punched that numbers for you just so you can see how low. I mean, this guy was shelling up for a minute and 30, 2 minutes, 2 minutes and 30 seconds of the round. The referee was consistently telling him, come on, you got to work. Like, he wasn't doing anything. And then he was having fun, too, not throwing punches, making faces, you know, looking into the camera and talking to his trainer from within the ring as if he had everything under control. But he was doing absolutely nothing to win the fight with Ruiz. While Ruiz was, again, it was a one-sided fight. Like, Godfrey did absolutely nothing. It was – I never seen – in all my years of watching, I've never seen anything like this. It was weird. But Ruiz did what he could, and he got a decision. I mean, other than that, Danny Valdivia defeated Jeremy Ramos by 6-round KO in the junior middleweight division on the undercard of this top rank on Unimas. And I'm mentioning Valdivia because he looked good, and his name is Chapulín. So my Mexican guys, isn't that like a superhero or whatever? But I know, you know, that when he was introduced, he did this huge jump. So I don't know. I guess that's part of the superhero, you know, the way Superman, Adonis Stevenson, goes into the Superman pose. This guy's like jumping high as hell in the ring. And he got the win, and he was solid, and he's a good-looking kid. And, you know, he really commits with his punches. He was working hard. It was a good back-and-forth fight, too. So I felt I had to mention that. I believe it was in the first round. They both knocked each other down. So it was a good scrap. And, you know, I wanted to mention it. So then, obviously, what we all, you know, were waiting for was the Pauly Malignaggi fight. And he got his 8-round unanimous decision win in the welterweight division to at least be able to retire in the win column. And speaking of win columns, Fyodor Chutunov versus Frank Bologna. Oh, my God. You know, listen, it's kind of hard for me. You know, I'm not even going to do it. I'm going to be as professional as possible and say, I watched this fight. Chutunov, I like him. I guess he's decent. I don't know how he's gonna fit, how he's gonna fare versus an athletic fighter. But you know, he's I was partially right. He's the brother of the guy that faced Eubanks. So, you know, Fedor is his brother. He's the better brother. Obviously, he got a win over Felix Sturm. And now, my problem is I watched the Box Nation stream. So, Bologna, man, and listen, I watched this Box Nation stream to try and memorize this last name. I'm sorry. I'm trying my hardest here. But this guy is trash, okay? You know, I wasn't even going to say that because I didn't want to take shots.
He underperformed, Ness. He underperformed. He's much better than that. He is.
Oh, you know, okay. You know, what I didn't get was why were the announcers, like, talking more about Frank than Chutinov, who was actually doing the work? He was landing so many right hands. I don't even know. The only thing I give Frank credit for is not going down, obviously. And
technically
no, he didn't go down. It was the other guy that went down. Remember?
No, I know, Frank, I know.
Frank also cheated and hit after the bell. This guy Chutinov, he's got some balls of steel. He was I'm not gonna say he was out, but he got put down. And that scared me because it's not like he stopped fighting when he heard the bell, Mario. He just got caught.
So you're right, you're absolutely right. Well said.
He didn't go down because of the bell and him letting off the gas or, you know, relaxing his body. No, he didn't hear it just like Frank didn't hear it, and he just got caught with a mean right hand that put him flat on his hiney, but it was after the bell. And again, you know, these guys, they were talking it up with something about Arthur Abraham. I mean, these are this guy's goals. You know, Chutinov's goals is to fight Arthur Abraham. I mean,
well, he mentioned the rematch with Felix Sturm. He actually meant to mention a rematch for Bologna, I think that's Bologna.
Again, I'm asking my UK listeners, why were these announcers talking more about Frank and the fact that he's got his heart on his sleeve and he's giving it his all and oh my God, I can't believe he's taking all these shots. But like, dude, he's losing. You're making it sound good that he's losing. I didn't understand it. But no need to stay on that too much. Let's just get right into some of these undercards on this last card on the PBC. Brian Parrilla defeated Patrick Boozer in fifth round TKO on a welterweight division. Andres Warwick defeated Mike Shepard by third round KO in a heavyweight division. Terrell Geisha continues to stay undefeated in the junior middleweight division by eight round unanimous decision over Elias Gonzalez. Now, things that we were able to see was Charles Martin. This was obviously after the main event, but you had to watch it on NBC Sports Net, I believe, or NBC Sports something. I know I watched
it. Yeah,
NBC Sports Net.
Yeah, right.
Now, I will say, you know, I rag on everybody's production. So on the NBC Sports Net app, Extra Live app for the iPhone, when I used that to watch this Charles Martin fight, there was no audio. Like, the three announcers, it was Daniel Jacobs and whoever else was on the left and the right to him. They had an entire conversation that they showed me, but I didn't get to hear. So get it together, people. Outside of that, Charles Martin, my opinion is he looks good, but he had a horrible body. I mean, that body, I mean, it was horrible. I mean, and first of all, look, man, I don't know what's up with these guys thinking it's okay to just come on TV like this. Like, dude, do them dreads. It looked like that was horrible. Listen, but he got some skill. He's a southpaw heavyweight, and he looked really good, but it was versus Vicente Sandez that, you know, didn't look like he even resembled the fighter. If anything, he looked more like a gardener or a plumber. He definitely had the backside of a plumber, you know, and he went down on his backside like a plumber. But did you guys catch the Charles Martin fight on this NBC Sports Net?
Yes,
I did.
Go ahead, Robbie. You go first.
I did. I caught it, and Martin, you know, didn't have much of a competition in there because the other guy, as you said, Ness, didn't even look like a fighter, and he basically dominated the thing from the beginning until it ended in the third round. I'd like to see him fight somebody with a little bit more skill because he looks like he's got some skills, but it's kind of hard to gauge when the guy was only around for less than three rounds.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. You said it perfectly, and that's pretty much the basis I was going to cover. But from pure comparison standpoint, I thought he fared better than Brazelli did, which I know we'll get to. And that's the one thing is Christopher Martin surprised me. I had seen him once in the past, and he looked better than what I remembered. But that said, you know, the most compelling aspect of his fight was that he thanked Al Haymon as a promoter after the and during the post fight, you know, which a lot of people have fun at his expense on Twitter. In case you missed it, he thanked Al Haymon like normal, but he said, "I want to thank my promoter, Al Haymon," which, you know, I don't know. I don't think anyone really caught it at that time on the telecast, but going back, you know, I think a lot of people noticed it. But if he's the representation of what we have to look forward to in the heavyweight division for PBC, I will say that I'm still not interested yet.
Well, we need to find out, Mario, what this guy has. I mean, this was more like a sparring session than a fight because the other guy couldn't handle what Martin was delivering. So, you know, you need to increase his competition level and put somebody in there that can actually fight back.
Definitely true. But, again, you know, this was what, his 21st fight, I believe?
That's correct, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, developmental fight, it is what it is. He looked sharp, though, I will say that. Very patient, didn't overexert himself or throw, you know, many punches. He was very accurate, too. I just want to see him versus better competition. Obviously, this is, you know, our first time. My first time. I'm surprised Myra's seen him. But he brought up Dominic Brazili, or Brazil, right? I think they just pronounced it Dominic Brazil, who defeated Fred Casey, right? It was Cassie, actually.
It's Casey.
Oh, Cassie? Okay, I thought it was Casey.
I think you're right. I think it's Casey.
I think it's Casey.
Singer. It's not the singer. What's the girl's name?
Cassie.
Okay, so no, it's Cassie.
It is Cassie, Ness. I'm sorry. It's Cassie.
It is Cassie. All right. I thought it was wrong.
I don't know. I heard the telecast saying Casey.
No,
but
it's
whatever.
Cassie.
We'll go with Fred for now. He lost by unanimous decision. Some people weren't happy about this. They felt that Brazil deserved to lose or at least a draw. I didn't score it because I didn't even think that this guy was going to struggle this much. Now, I should have known better, I guess, but, you know, I thought the areola was on a decline, and it turns out Fred is just a lot tougher than we thought or Brazil is a lot worse than what we thought because he looked bad, okay? I'm sorry. You know, you can't hide what was going on there. This guy is 6'7", 278 pounds, and he was letting little itty-bitty Fred punch him all in the face.
Yeah.
I mean, it made no sense to me.
Can I say something? That's right. I saw the fight. That was one of the exciting fights for me when I saw it. Like, I expected it to be easy for Dominic, and I the way he was speaking before the fight, and, you know, I like to say I judge fights by the whiplashing and the head getting lashed, and that's what Cassie was producing. You know, there was a commercial that was like the all-in burger, and it was all-in Cassie when it started up again, and, you know, I felt he got robbed. I was one of those people that said it, so that was one of the exciting fights for me.
I wouldn't say that he got robbed, not at all. I think that what it boiled down to was that Cassie did enough to win. But so did Brazil. I thought that they both put up a valiant enough effort for the scores to be close. But the shutout score for Brazil was just awful. I mean, there was no way, no how that you scored it a shutout. I mean, what fight were you watching? You know, there was no sense of urgency from Brazil. He was continuing to let his hands go with no sense of urgency. It seemed like he didn't really have much emphasis on fighting. You know, I think and this is the problem when you're a guy in the Haymon stable that's used to fighting that level of opposition, you're used to your opponent eventually giving in. You know, he's either beat before the bell rings or he eventually gets beat throughout. Hold on. And I think that he was expecting these punches to have more effect. They never did. And Casey continued to weather the storm when he was in trouble. I thought that he won the middle rounds. I thought Brazil came back at the end and did good enough to at least make the scores close, but it certainly was not a shutout by any means.
No, I mean, I thought this fight could have been 6-4 either way, or possibly even a draw. And, you know, the thing is this. You're in the fight. You know, you may underestimate your opponent, but once, after a couple rounds, you see this guy isn't going anywhere, and this guy is hitting you, then you got to make adjustments, and no adjustments were made. This guy, Brazil, no offense, he telegraphs everything, stands straight up, very stiff. He just doesn't look like a fighter, and I'm not sure if he could ever be a fighter. You know, these guys that are athletes think that they can just transition into this sport, and it's not like any other. You have to be born with these type of skills, and if you have them and you don't even know you have them, then someone can bring them out in you. But I don't think there's anything in this guy that basically shows me that he could ever be a real top-level fighter. I just don't see it.
No, and the problem with Dominic Brazil is, you know, he's been getting a certain level of opposition, and he was finally faced with somebody last night, Fred Cassey, who gave Ariel a fit and wasn't going to go away. And, you know, I had this score to draw. I didn't think Brazil deserved to win. And off of this performance, Dominic Brazil has got a lot of improving to do, because there's no way he will ever beat a top 15 heavyweight. I mean, I don't know if he'll ever be what Al Haymon and the PBC want him to be. His 16-0 record, he's lucky to still have an O, because I see if they increase his competition and put him in against, you know, somebody like a Amir Mansour or somebody like that who's actually fought a guy like Cassie, I don't think Brazil is going to be able to survive some of these fights. So, and the one judge, I don't know how in the hell you could score at 190. There's no way that was a shutout. Absolutely not. And see, this is the problem with our sport. We'll never get true casual fans to be constant fans of this sport when you have questionable decisions such as this, you know, on somebody's scorecard. I really wonder how much experience this judge had in actually scoring fights, because there's no way that was a shutout.
Casual, as always, dropping the ball. Mm-mm-mm. Can't ever rely on my team, I tell you, but I'll just say this.
You're serious?
I love it when my own panelists say something that I can get in their ass for. So, Robbie and Mario, it's your turn. Because, you know, you guys are ragging on Dominic Brazil, and I don't understand why. Let's keep in mind, like Robbie made very obvious, this is his 16th fight. Let's just ask Amir Mansour when he faced Fred Cassey, okay? Let's just ask him that. Because if I'm not mistaken, he has over 20 or 40, and he's 42, so I don't see him rushing to get in the ring with anyone. And let's bring up, actually, the fact that Dominic Brazil, he's also fought Nagy Aguilera, who fought, I don't know who, Chris Arreola, when Chris Arreola had already fought Vitaly Klitschko, and possibly even Thomas Adamek, maybe, I don't know, I'm not using BoxRec. You do it because you dropped the ball, not me. You guys are the ones ragging on the kid for stepping up after 15 fights. So what? He didn't look great.
I'm ready now.
No, he didn't look great, but he's only in his 16th fight.
It doesn't matter.
Name someone else that has three notable journeymen of that caliber on their resume right now at 16-0. Please do. Please. Hey, go ahead.
No, I wasn't going to mention no name drops, but I wanted to say I thought he was going to do incredible to then face somebody like the bomber Wilder. You know what I'm saying? And then I was
too soon, man. It's too soon.
I knew you guys were gonna say too soon.
But he's talking about setting up, though. He's talking about setting up, right? Casual.
I'm talking about setting up. I thought he was gonna do something impressive, so that would be the chatter, you know. And then that's why I watched the Andy Ruiz fight, because I was like, damn, I saw all the heavyweight fights only, by the way. So I was thinking like maybe Andy Ruiz or something is brewing for this heavyweight division, and I didn't see much from Dominic. Even if it's 16.
Casual, now you're not dropping the ball. Now you're passing the ball. That's an assist right there. Scottie Pippen and Jordan, he just passed for me. Alley-oop, boom, I'm dunking it all on Mario's face, because guess what? Andy Ruiz old Mr. Top Rank over there, he's still in 8 rounders. He ain't never fighting no Nagy Aguilera or no Fred Casey or anybody else on Brazil's resume at all, and he's supposed to be more talented.
So does he get points for stepping up and not looking good, or what do we do here?
Exactly. I mean, yes, exactly.
Does he get an A for effort? Does he get an A for effort, or what is he? What
no.
He gets an unsatisfactory.
Okay.
But we don't condemn a man for stepping up on his 16th fight. I mean, who are we?
Who's condemning him for stepping up? We're just saying he didn't.
To the panel. Oh,
He's an Olympian. At the end of the day, there is a certain criteria. Neither did Errol Spence. There is a certain criteria that goes into a fighter being set up at this stage. You're right. Fred Casey is a tough fight. And it is the kind of fight that I give Brazil all the credit for. But I'm not going to give him credit for not looking good in the fight and then saying that, oh, we'll wait to see for next time. I'm not saying that we write the book on Brazil, that it's done. All I'm saying is that there are many more holes in this kid's game than I ever considered.
You know, you didn't say it's done. But what you and Robbie said is, well, these Haymon guys, they're used to get, but he ain't used to nothing. He came up the hard way. This is not the easy way. This ain't the easy way fighting Fred Casey right now.
Sorry to say, if I can interject, this guy's another Seth Mitchell waiting to happen, in my opinion.
All
I want us to do is not get caught up in the fact that this is just one fight on a level to a bunch of more. And please, weirdos out there, don't email me saying that Dominic Brazil is my favorite fighter. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying we don't write the book on a guy in his developmental fight.
I hear you. You want to give him not a pass, but you want to give him another look. You don't think it was enough, and that's fine. I just thought he was better than what
Listen,
I saw
he
yesterday.
He said the right things, too, in his post-fight interview. Come on, he didn't go out there and fake it. He said, look, I got a lot to work on. You know, he said it. Listen, the man of the hour and the man who stole the show was Deontay Wilder.
Wait, before you move on, I want to say one thing about Dominic, too. Before his fight, you know, considering his height and Casey's height, I was, they said that Dominic had the age advantage, and I never give age advantage. I always give height as an advantage. And he looked bad, bro. I'm sorry, but it was a 16 fight. He looked like he can't keep up with somebody tougher than Casey or somebody equal to him. So. That's all I have to say.
Yeah. So moving on to Deontay Wilder, who really, in my opinion, stole the show. Now, I know there's some mixed reviews on this performance, but Deontay Wilder did defeat Johan Duhapis by 11th round TKO for Wilder's WBC heavyweight title. Now, I want to make quick mention of the arena, and I don't know how many people were there. I don't have those statistics right now or those numbers. But what I will say is that main section that they gave us on TV, I'm starting to question if those people were real, because they were super enthusiastic in those first couple of rows, right? Like they were going crazy for some action in there. People were getting about their feet. It was insane. But that being said, Wilder impressed me. I know that he didn't impress a lot of you guys. I know that. I understand. He got hit with a lot of jabs. He backed up in a straight line. You know, he did a ton of stuff. His balance is still off. But he did so many things that I was impressed with. I mean, the way that he walked this guy down and he was digging to the body, he showed his inside game. So many heavyweights. I'm tired of seeing Vladimir Klitschko hold guys. This is a guy that probably isn't going to let him hold him. He was using that forearm, digging to the body. You know, that impressed me, because guess who else did that? Tyson Fury did that to Steve Cunningham. So now we know that we got two guys who could probably give us a good fight on the inside. Don't forget that the way that he was sidestepping and digging upwards with that left uppercut and then coming with the right uppercut. I mean, listen, again, I know he did some bad things, but he showed us another tool in the toolbox for sure. The inside game, that movement. When he did that one thing where he had both his hands over the guy's head and he shimmied to the left and shimmied to the right and made the hoppers think he was going to go to the left, then boom, dug to the body with the right hook and up to the head with the uppercut. I mean, this guy was working, bro. And what I like is that he wants to entertain. Now, I will tell you this. In my opinion, most of his issues come for a couple of reasons. And the main ones are, I think it's anticipation, right? Is it? No, I don't know. He's over-anxious, actually. Not anticipate. He's over-anxious. He so badly wants to impress you, especially in his hometown. But you got to get behind a guy that talks the way he talks, and he's going for the show. I mean, did you see the last punch? You know, yes, it was all, you know, him off balance, but he was lunging because he wants to finish. He was lunging in, you know, a guy half dead on the ropes. He's still trying to kill him. Like, he's entertaining to me as long as it lasts, right? So I'm going to pass the ball, but before I do, I got some weirdos on my timeline, you know? And they're like, oh, Joshua kills him. We'll tell Joshua fight him right now. And you know it's not going to happen. Eddie Hearn won't make it, and you won't make it. Let's let Joshua get to where he's got to get to, and then that fight happens if it happens. If Wilder gets knocked out in the process or in the meantime, then Wilder is everything that you thought he was. But till then, let's not make ridiculous comparisons. One guy's a world champion and proven. The other guy's on the way up the ladder. Like, let him get up the ladder. Unless he's ready to jump like Rigondeaux and Lomachenko. Until he does that, let's leave him in his category. That's all I'm saying. Who's up?
I mean, I agree. I think that people are going to just dump on this guy because he was knocking guys out in 1-3 rounds. And now when that doesn't happen, all the criticisms are going to come barreling in on him. You know, I think that Dumfries was durable. I thought he was a better fighter than most people are giving him credit for. I just think that I'm seeing a lot of improvements with Wilder in terms of the jab is more active. He's placing it better. He's not loading up with his shots anymore. He's just shooting his shots now. The left hook is coming off more smoothly. I think he's stepping off to the side, giving himself better punching angles now. So I think he's getting better. I don't agree so much with the balance. I think he is starting to get his feet underneath him. But I do agree with the over-anxiousness. That in terms of that, you will see some sequences where he will jump in a little bit. But for the most part, I think more often than not now he is kind of settling down. He is being more patient, and he is trying to, you know, work his way through the fight because he knows the competition's getting better, so he's not just jumping all over the guy and trying to blow them up in one round anymore. Another criticism I could have, though, is the body work. I didn't see any body work. I think that's an area that needs improvement. I think that's an area that needs to be worked on, and I think that's something he should be doing more of.
I disagree with you on that. He did a lot of body work. He was landing right hands to the body, and he was jabbing to the body.
I think he could make a commitment down there when he's up close. I don't see him like putting one or two, two or three shots together downstairs. I'm not saying he doesn't do it at all. I think he could do more. I think he could do more, especially if he committed to the body a little more early on. He probably could have gotten him out of there earlier instead of just going with that. I thought early on he was going with the headshots a little too much.
Well, I think when you're fighting at home, I think you know, you want to impress more. It might be a good idea to fight in other locations because the fights are going to get tougher. I mean, he still got the mandatory with Povetkin coming up, if they can ever put that together. But I do like what he did.
Robbie, let me just address something really quick. I'm sorry to cut you off, but you said something that I have to educate people on. This Povetkin thing, right? Povetkin chose to have a fight with Maurice Vak in Russia. Not Wilder. Wilder didn't pay him step-aside money to fight Dunhapis in Birmingham. Povetkin, Alexander Povetkin, the guy that everyone's saying would knock him out, chose to fight Maurice Vak in Russia, okay? The 7-foot guy who lost to Vladimir Klitschko. That's how it went down. The information is on our YouTube channel. We spoke to the president of the WBC, who mandates mandatories, okay? Again, that fight is happening in November. So then after that, Povetkin has to be willing to right away fight, because if Wilder just fought in September, that means he could be ready for December or January or February. Could Povetkin be ready for December, January, or February? That is the question. So when these negotiations happen, keep that in mind. Stop being imbeciles. Educate yourselves.
Well, I know. I was aware that he had another fight, but I was just bringing it
Robbie,
up.
Robbie, I'm not directing that at you, my friend. You're my buddy.
Okay. All right. Okay. Anyway, but no, I was very impressed. Unlike Brazil, where I wasn't impressed with Wilder, I am impressed. Duhapis proved to be a durable fighter. He gave him some rounds, and it proved to be an interesting fight. And I think it's going to pay off for Deontay Wilder in the long run that he actually had to go round with Duhapis. And I think this is going to be better for Wilder's future to have a fight like this. So for those that are criticizing it, yeah, we didn't know who he was, but he actually proved to be a worthy challenger and actually gave Wilder a good fight.
Yeah. So as far as me, again, you know, I wasn't one of those guys all hyped up looking for a knockout from Deontay Wilder. Again, I was judging his opponent by the 19 KOs that he has on his record. And Deontay Wilder is 6'7". So I was, bell round, first round opened. I was watching. It was a very exciting fight. Very first open excitement as well as he gets hit and falls against the ropes and looked like Floyd. So, yeah, I was impressed by Deontay Wilder. One thing that really surprised me was the mouse under his eye that just kept growing and growing into a fat burger. And, Deontay Wilder is the truth. I think that if he goes against Klitschko next, it's going to be – because I'm jumping it right to Klitschko, because I read some headline today that said Klitschko in 2016. And I don't know, man, that's going to be a tough fight for Wilder. But I'm still impressed. I'm still, you know, my pulse still beats heavy when Wilder has a fight. And I'm glad he went to the 11th round and stopped him. Good fight, Wilder.
Yeah, I mean,
well,
he had
I'm going to say this. Look, y'all are talking about his performance, and I did see some things towards the end. His sidestepping was really good, the way he was getting off the uppercuts. That's about all I'm going to say for Deontay's performance. I don't care how good or bad he looked. He was in there with a punching bag. Ness said that he saw Wilder getting hit, or he had other people saying that Wilder got hit. When? Who? Was there another fighter in the ring last night? Because I didn't see anybody throwing back. This man continued to walk Wilder back and did absolutely nothing. I give him all the credit. He is very tough and very durable. He was being walked back. I mean, he was walking back Wilder on the brink of taking some very, very punishing offense, and he did nothing. He did absolutely nothing. He was there. If he hurt any part of Wilder's body, it was his hands, because of how many shots he took. Yeah, it was impressive that eventually Wilder found the body, although I disagree with Ness. I think he didn't go to the body a lot. It was good work, but it certainly wasn't a lot at all. It could have been a much, much more. I think that what we saw from Wilder was a stay-busy fight. He needed a memorable performance in front of what was probably the largest audience he's ever performed in front of. And that's fine. You're trying to build a star out of the next great American heavyweight. And for those on Blog Talk that can't see me, I just used air quotes because I'm a tool. And I think that when you go beyond the facet of what Wilder can be, you have to look at what he is right now. I don't know how much more growing he has. He is a 50-50, if not underdog, against the top five heavyweights right now, this moment. I don't think he survives that gauntlet. I really don't. Maybe he can beat Povetkin. Maybe he can beat Bryant. You know, maybe he can beat Fury. But he certainly can't beat all of them. I promise you that. And Beeb's waving, and I agree. I don't know if he beats any of them. But I could see him getting off a win or two. But I can't see him beating all of them. Not at all. He's not there. I don't know if he ever will be.
So
I would like to see him against Povetkin as quickly as possible.
Okay. So, Povetkin, because I was just going to ask for a fantasy matchup. So, you still want the Povetkin next.
Absolutely.
What's Povetkin going to do if he can't knock out Wilder?
Well, I mean, it's a fair question. You know, is he going to outbox Wilder? I don't think so. But is Wilder going to really outbox Povetkin? With what footwork? You know,
Joking, right? You're joking.
No,
right?
I'm not joking at all. He has great athleticism.
You're talking about the man that outboxed a slicker fighter than Povetkin.
Okay,
Povetkin isn't as slick as Bermain Stavern. Let's just stop.
Okay, but you're talking about styles. Okay, you're talking about styles. I'm talking about substance. You're talking about styles. I'm talking about substance, okay? Because you can say that, you know, for what it's worth, Gamboa can be slick at times, okay? It doesn't make him better than, you know, other guys that aren't. You know, it's not about the style. Wilder's not at that level. Where, oh, he beat one slick style, he can beat another. Like, no. There are levels to this shit. You know that better than anyone.
And the level that you don't want to let the people know.
Is a world-class fighter.
Whatever. The level you don't want to let the people know is that your boy Teddy Atlas kept Povetkin for Vladimir Klitschko for like 10 years.
Okay. And what's that prove? You're talking about the same thing as somebody losing to Floyd Mayweather. But what does that prove, though? Because he couldn't beat Klitschko. What does that prove?
No, I didn't say he couldn't beat Klitschko. I said the fact that Teddy Atlas didn't want him to fight Klitschko.
But did he?
He had to leave
Atlas. Let me ask you,
Did
he fight Klitschko?
Yeah, he did.
And Wilder never will. Because not only are they keeping away from him, they're pretending as though there are no heavyweights outside of the U.S. Did you see that broadcast last night?
Again, you're lying.
How am I lying?
I'm going to explain. This is exactly the reason that I said what I said about Brazil. Not because I think Brazil's good, because he looked bad. But you're saying this. You keep saying they and him and Haymon, and it's not true. Because they mentioned that Vladimir Klitschko was the true heavyweight. They showed a picture of him with him and all his belts. But here you are on the show lying again.
Ness, can I say something, please, really quick? Everyone is, and I'm not saying you, Mario, don't take it like I'm directing these comments at you, but a lot of people are basically jumping all over Povetkin just because he knocked out Mike Perez. And, you know, everyone was saying he was trash before that. Let's not forget the fight he had against Marco Huck, in which I thought Marco Huck won that fight. So I think he lost to a cruiserweight. So I'm not really sold on Povetkin. He looked horrible against Klitschko. Jennings did better than him against Klitschko. I think Deontay Wilder would knock Povetkin out. I really believe that. I think Deontay Wilder would keep him on the outside, and I don't think that Povetkin would be very effective, willing, and trying to reach the taller Wilder. I just don't see him being effective. I don't think he can touch him. I don't think he's going to be at all successful in that fight. I think style-wise, Wilder will box the shit out of him, in my opinion.
See, what Wilder has is that Gennady-Golovkin effect. And now, yes, I know Gennady has a way better defense than Wilder, but what they both have is the power. And if you can't knock him out, he's going to knock you out. It's just that simple. Duhapis was there, and we didn't know anything about him, and we all thought he was a bum because he was some Frenchman, and let's keep him at a bum. But the fact that his chin was that durable made him have to work to get the win. And that's what I'm saying. Again, one guy versus another guy. The other guy stood no chance because he couldn't knock out Wilder. And it was just a matter of time before Wilder knocked him out. You can't take those punches for that man. That's why Gennady's beating. You got to be able to take the punches. It's not about who hits harder, who takes them punches better. Because if Wilder isn't getting knocked out, how the fuck do you stop that reach, man? You see, this dude is hitting you with uppercuts, left hooks. Listen, that left hook that he was doing when he was off the ropes and he was sliding out, and then the minute you try to cut the ring off, whap, he was hitting you with that left hook, and he was sending it right on Dunhopper's face. Listen, don't tell me this guy's a bum. He's not a bum. And they better get him right now. Get him right now, because a little bit more, he's going to be too good for them.
My last word on this is going to be Ness and all those others that feel like Ness. Do not confuse athleticism with slick skills or the ability to use technical the ability to showcase technical ability with that slick style. Don't confuse that athleticism for that, because you could be athletic but it doesn't mean that you can translate that athleticism into real technique.
But he's translating it, though. But he is.
Against who? Against.
But he is, though.
That was my last word. Against who?
Okay. Hey, listen. It's all good. All I'm saying is this. I haven't seen Tyson Fury do anything like that. Anything like that. I haven't seen Tyson Fury knock out anybody. Anybody. It doesn't matter who. Because Tyson only got like less than 20 fights, man. You know, there's a lot of hype on this dude. But who has he fought? Okay? So how are you going to tell me that his 14 fucking knockouts, he's going to knock out Deontay Wilder, who not only could box, hit you with the stick, and use the fucking whole ring, but knock you out? Tyson doesn't have anything. What does he got? But all of a sudden, you know, it's Tyson's better. Tyson's better. Why? Because he's calling out Klitschko? Because he called out Hay? But those fights ain't happening. They ain't happening. Is it his fault? Maybe not. Obviously not with the Klitschko and the Cavs stuff, and probably not with the Hay thing. But unfortunately, they haven't happened. He hasn't been able to step up. Only thing we got to gauge him is two fights off of Chisora. One where he was like 300 pounds, and the other when he was already ground meat, okay? Ground beef, that's what he was. So please, man, yo, miss me with the bullshit, okay? Wilder, Fury, I want it now. Fury doesn't have a fight. Fury doesn't have a fight.
I know you ain't talking about me, dog. You? What?
Fury don't got a fight, so please, set it up. Do it.
I don't know Fury. I just see his post.
24-0 with 18 knockouts, baby. He's the truth.
Fury doesn't have a Bermain Stiverne on his resume yet. Not one. Because Chisora is a born loser. All he did is lose. You know that song by Khaled, all you do is win. This guy, all he do is lose, lose, lose. No matter what, he getting that ass beat every single time. He
only had Stiverne's claim to fame is areola.
No, he only had one fight, my man. He only had one fight. Where we think it's like, oh, he should have won that, and that was versus Hellenius. That's it.
I value Cunningham over Areola. I value that win over Areola, please.
Yeah, you see
you're embarrassing yourself.
No, you're just a UK fanboy. You value a cruiserweight a heavyweight beating a cruiserweight over a true heavyweight.
I value skill.
I think Steve Cunningham's better than Bermain Stiverne, in my opinion. I think he would beat him.
And you're probably right.
Yo, Steve Cunningham will get buried next to the Rocky statue if he got in the ring with Wilder. And he's going to go there because he's in that realm. He will die, and you'd go. You guys know that. You know that. Come on.
He won't do any worse than Bermain Stiverne. I think he'll do better than Bermain Stiverne did.
He'll certainly do better than the Frenchman last night.
Yo, how's he going to... Steve Cunningham?
Yes, you're talking about Bermain Stiverne like he's Mike Tyson.
No, we're talking about Wilder. How is Steve Cunningham going to take that Wilder power?
No, you were talking about Stiverne. Don't try to switch it up on Beeb. You were talking about Stiverne looking better than Cunningham in that fight with Wilder. That's what you said.
I'm saying Stiverne is a better name. You guys were saying Cunningham's a better win for Fury. That's what you're saying, right?
Beeb said that Cunningham's better than Stiverne, which I tend to agree, and you said that Stiverne does better against Wilder than Cunningham would.
I didn't say any of that. What I'm saying is this. I'm sorry. All I'm saying is Stiverne is a better fighter than Steve Cunningham in the heavyweight division. I'm sorry.
I disagree.
What has Cunningham done? It's black and white, man. You guys can't make them better. What did he do in the heavyweight division, Beeb? Professor, tell me.
I think he beat a lot of the guys he didn't get the decision against.
Yeah, so do I.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Fringe contenders.
What's Areola?
Nobody.
What's Areola?
At least he's a former world title challenger or something. He's been to the mountaintop. Glaskov's a guy on the way up. He's struggling with someone on the way up. So you guys are dogging Dominic Brazil.
I think Thomas Adamek.
Hold on. You guys dogged. Wait a minute. Check this out. You guys dogged Dominic Brazil when Glaskov fought Steve Cunningham. Didn't he have 16, 17 fights? Stop it with the bull crap.
I think Mansoor is a quality fighter. I think Thomas Adamek's a quality fighter.
Fury hasn't fought Mansoor.
I'm talking about Cunningham.
Steve Cunningham.
Steve Cunningham. And I think he should have got the decision against Adamek. I thought he got robbed.
That's what y'all don't get. Listen to me. I'm going to tell y'all this. I'm going to pause this for a second. Fighter, that's what Ness does. He tries to switch up the convo every time when he sees that he's derailing. You're derailing.
I'm not switching it.
He ain't going to beat Bivol.
You guys are making it about Cunningham when it's about Fury.
No. Yeah, fine. But then you took the bait. Don't pretend like you didn't take the
switched,
bait.
You switched. You started.
You guys mentioned Cunningham. And I said, Wilder win is bigger than the Cunningham. That's all I said.
You just character assassinated the best heavyweight in the world, Tyson Fury. and you think they're going to get away with that?
No, I mentioned facts.
Me on the panel? You think I'm going to allow that?
I mentioned facts.
And I did too. Steve Cunningham's a better fighter than Bermain Stiverne. And he's a better fighter than Dumfries.
Beeb, you've been doing this far too long to sit here and lie. Stiverne was the WBC champion. You can't take that away. It wasn't a vacant – was it a vacant title? Yes, it was. All right, but he still rematched Areola. He still rematched him, so it made it
– Please don't do this.
No, you don't do that.
You're embarrassing yourself here.
Yo, I can't – so it doesn't mean anything that he was a world champion and Steve Cunningham wasn't.
No, does not. Absolutely
Robbie,
zero.
Fine. You can talk about it. You can talk about it, Ness, and that's fine. I understand where you're coming from in terms of legitimate titles.
This is insane.
But I'm talking about what's a tougher fight.
If Steve Cunningham fought Chris Areola, he would have been WBC champion too. Check yeah.
Exactly.
Check
wow.
Man.
That's it. It's Check over. Man. You know what, Ness? How about Ness go get some coffee? We'll restart the intro. We can do this show from scratch, and you know what? You can save face. It's all right. We'll give you your pride.
Listen, it's all good. It's all good. Everybody has an opinion. Everybody has an opinion, and you guys are all entitled to it.
I think you could be WBC champion if you fought Chris Areola. You'd be wearing that green belt right now. You'd be behind that mic with that green belt on if you fought Chris Areola.
Unfortunately.
I think you could beat him. I think you could beat him.
Steve Cunningham is ranked number 11. By Box Rec.
He's the truth. Unfortunately. He's ranked number 7 by the Beeb.
My boy is number 4. End of story. You already know who's in front of him. So, you know, you guys can sit here and lie all you want. Facts don't lie. That's it. So let's take some callers here. Talk to me.
What's going on, fellas?
Cooling.
What up?
Yo, can y'all hear me?
Loud and clear.
Fellas.
We hear you, brother.
Yeah, we hear you.
All right. So listen, Mr. Top Rank Mario talking that bullshit about, the fighters, if this is what we have to look forward to. I think, you know, when you're talking about a development fight, and Ness mentioned it, a development fight, this is what we're facing in the industry and in the sport right now. So everybody needs to take a few steps back before we start talking if Cunningham fought this, if Ariel. These people didn't fight each other. We got to go with who fought, with who had belts, who beat who, and who lost. That's how you judge in fights. Because one minute we make it convenient for the rankings and for the belts, and then we throw it out the window just because we want to hype somebody. Or then we throw and say, oh, it's a problem with the promoter. There's not enough good fighters in the stable to say that he fought enough quality contenders. If we're going to spread the bullshit on one side of the bread, put it on the other side, and let's just eat shit sandwiches. If not, let's just cut it out, all right? Deontay Wilder is a way better fight than we would have ever expected. You know what I'm saying? Whether he fought, I think, the position he's in, whether he would have fought Cassie, whether he would have fought he probably would have beat the shit out of Brazil, but if he would have fought Cassie, if he would have fought the cat he fought last night, these are all steps in that direction. So what? We're going to put him in the ring with a Mansour. We're going to put him in the ring with Jennings or put him in the ring with whoever. Those fights are there too, but every fight isn't going to be the fight where somebody like Mario gets to say, oh, well, see, that's why we can't watch this promoter no more because the fights ain't shit. We can't keep doing that. And that's what I got to say about it, fellas.
Bomb Squad!
Damn, I never heard on being that hot.
Hey, man. He's mad. He came at you, man. He came at you.
He did.
I mean, I believe when Beeb spoke, I was like, oh, wow, good point, Beeb. Cunningham could have been the champion.
Nah, exactly. But that's what I'm saying. You can't what if a resume, bro. It's only what he actually did, you know. And Tyson.
I hear you. And Amin explained it well. He did. That was a fair point.
But
I give Tyson a lot of credit. Let me just say, because guys hang on certain words. I give him a ton of credit for facing an undefeated Chisora many, many years ago. They sold that fight to me. I remember listening to it on podcasts all over. They were bigging it up. And it was good. But then Chisora came in like 200 and something, 270 pounds. Like, come on. Like, and that's still the biggest name on his resume till this day. Come on.
But can I say something? To smash that guy's argument, if one guy is fighting better opposition and the other guy isn't, just because he's got a title belt, that doesn't mean anything, number one. And number two, he's fighting Doomfist. Tyson Fury signed to fight Klitschko.
But come he's on. Not fighting him, though.
Well, he will in November. When he's going to fight him in November.
But the point I mean made was, let's stop what-ifing. You're what-ifing.
Yeah. And it's a happening. Fair point.
Well,
and
I still think I
you
still
got one guy fighting. You got one guy fighting, and everyone else in the division is just waiting around. You got Brian Jennings telling people. Brian Jennings told like three of us already personally he wasn't interested in Luis Ortiz.
But why are we going to put so much stock in the rankings, though? I mean, Stavern was in the right place at the right time. He fought Areola for the title. Let's That's just look works. At it. We got to look at it for what it is. We just can't be, because a guy's champion, he's the best in the division. How many fighters have belts but aren't the best in their divisions? Doesn't mean it's a different type of way of looking at things. You got to look at who is the best. Who's the best?
No, you're right. I'll just put it in.
So many guys don't get opportunities, though. So many guys get phased out. Boxing sucks like that. Yeah. So we have to be the objective observers and say who's the best.
Not in the heavyweight
division. We have to be the ones.
That would be a great speech for the welterweight division, but not in the heavyweight division, because Vladimir Klitschko gave everyone a shot.
Tyson That's fair. Let's go. Let's go to the
show right now, because he chose to wait this long, just like Deontay Wilder chose to wait this long.
That's a good point. Let's take it back out to the street. Before we do, though, I do want to re-mention that y'all guys use the hashtag. And if you got questions, if you got comments, use the hashtag. And we're making it a point. All of us are making it a point to check and make sure that we start looking at it more and getting y'all's questions on air. So if you're waiting online, you know, and you're at the bottom of the list, you called in a little late, hey, you know, a good way of cheating is to hashtag us, ask the question, or make your comment, and we'll get to it, mention it quickly, and move on.
916, you're up. Who's this?
It's Ray from Sac, man. How y'all doing, man?
What's going on, brother?
What up?
Nothing much, man. I just had to say, man, this is getting real good, y'all, talking all this, all these different boxes. But, hey, one thing about that dude that Wilder fought last night, what's his name? Dupai? That's his name, right? I'm saying it right?
Drop off or something.
Hello? Yeah, Dunhapas. Dunhapas.
Yeah, Dunhapas.
Something like that.
Yeah, Dunhapas. One of the dudes he lost to is the same dude that just knocked David Price out. So, I mean, and he didn't get knocked out by him either. So, I mean, I think that people really should give Wilder a little bit more credit for stopping that dude, because he was real tough. And, I mean, he already shown that he was tough. He barely lost to that dude. I forgot that goddamn dude, man, but... Yeah, that was a good fight, man. And, yeah, I think he'll knock out Povetkin as well. I have to agree with that. As well, dude on the undercard, Brazil. Yeah, man, he's sloppy, but, I mean, hey, you never know, man. People can get better. People can end up getting knocked out. That's what's going to end up happening with him. That's all I really got to say. Once again, man, I just want to go ahead and shout out, man. Ness is keeping it real on the show, man.
Thank you, brother. Thank you for calling in, man. We appreciate it.
Remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
Truly the only way to, you know, show your support, really. Real quick from the hashtag TBV podcast, Beast Mode says that Takam is a pure boxer. Is a better pure boxer than Wilder, and Povetkin laid him out. Yeah, well, you know, Povetkin also laid out Perez, you know. Listen, and Wilder laid out 33 other people, you know. Listen, knockouts happen in the heavyweight division. That's all I can say. Moving on, we got JD, Jacob Daniel from Texas.
What's going on, man?
What up?
I just got one thing to bring up. It disturbed the shit out of me on the last show. I heard Stu come on here and say, we heard him many times come on and say about how, you know, guys like Broner and Mayweather, they are basically, you know, a disgrace is his favorite word to use when it comes to, you know, how these guys sell fights and whatnot. And I don't understand why that didn't apply to Tyson Fury. You know what I mean? When in that press conference, he actually was like, well, you know, we're getting tired of the traditional press conferences. And I just saw a huge – I don't even know why y'all didn't call him out when he said that shit, because he's always calling – I want to say, I'll say an American fighter a disgrace when they do it. But when Tyson Fury do it, it's like, he was like, oh, well, you know, I just found it real exciting. Like, get the fuck out of here, man. But about the Deontay Wilder fight, we keep saying that, I'm a fan of Deontay Wilder. We keep saying that, it's something missing there, man. It's like he got to sharpen up that damn pencil. And when he do, I don't know if he got to bring another trainer in or maybe somebody like Barry Hunter or something just to go in that corner and help him out, like sharpen that damn pencil up. But when he do, it's going to be dangerous, man. I don't see no heavyweight. And I like his stamina. I mean, you don't see too many heavyweights with stamina like that.
Mute yourself on Skype.
But yeah.
Yo, could you turn your radio down, please?
Yeah.
Go ahead, JD. Just he's gonna hang up on it. Go ahead.
All right, well, yeah, I just wanted to say that, man. I don't see too many heavyweights with, you know, with the endurance that Wilder has, and that might be dangerous for the, you know, for the heavyweight class, man. I see good things for Wilder if he just sharpened that damn pencil up, like I said. That's all I got, man.
All right, JD, thanks for calling in, brother.
Sorry about that, JD.
We got GT Kid from Atlanta. What up?
Hey, can you hear me?
Loud and clear, brother.
Yeah. What's going on, Ness, Rodney, Mario? Deontay Wilder, man, I'm still not impressed. I think he's kind of a bum. Well, he's not a bum, but he's just not proven, you know. I'm just not impressed with him. I didn't see the fight, but, I mean, you know, the guy's from overseas and he's no name. Man, I wanted to talk about Adrian Broner's way off topic, but I think Adrian Broner's like probably one of the best at 140 and 147. But no one ever talks about his counterpunching, and he's got fast hands, but he throws really, really bad counters. He throws this sweeping left hook that he always misses with, and he's way out of position. And I think if Adrian Broner would just tighten up his counterpunching and straighten his punches up, man, I think he'd keep a lot of these guys off of him. You know, he probably could have won the Maidana fight. He could have definitely beat what's the guy's name we just lost to? Sean Porter. He probably could have beat Sean Porter. He could probably beat Amir Khan. He could beat Kell Brooks. But that's all I got, man. Hey, y'all doing great with the show, man. Y'all keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
That was a good call, GT.
Listen, guys, I want to get your attention on these tweets here, because some of them are interesting and they're on topic. 33 absolute bums. His power reminisced massively overrated Malik Scott, and Lyakovich took dives clearly. I shouldn't have even read that one. Obviously, that was dumb. No one takes dives. How can Stavern be slicker than Povetkin when Povetkin's defense is far more versatile and better and is a gold medalist? From from Wassam. Any thoughts, my panelists? You guys what are you guys doing over there?
I'm looking for
you can't take that one. That's pretty basic, bro. Man. That's a pretty basic answer.
Stavern's
not really slick. Neither guy's really slick because both guys get hit a lot. Both guys do this shit all the time. I mean, how is this slick? This isn't slick. I mean, come on, man. I think people need to realize what slick is. I think Mario explained it perfectly before. You know, being technical and athletic, it's two different things, man. And I don't think Stiverne basically is a slick fighter. I don't know where he gets that being slick. I don't see it. Who is he slick against? Areola?
Yeah, that's the biggest thing. I think that if you look at the comp and you compare it to that, then fine. I guess you could draw these assumptions, but you're operating within the confines of the heavyweight division and the opponents they face. And yeah, of course, it's going to make guys look better than they probably actually are.
I mean, realistically speaking, how many slick heavyweights do we really have out there right now? Can you really think of? Who's a real slick counter-punching heavyweight? I don't see
it. Stiverne was the counter-punching heavyweight.
I don't think so.
Oh, yeah. No, he didn't counter-punch Areola at all.
Everyone counter-punches Areola. So did Thomas Adamack. I mean, come on.
Well, Thomas Adamack was actually being first. He wasn't counter-punching.
He was counter-punching, too. He was hitting him at all distances, backing up, moving forward as well. Come on, man. You could counter-punch Areola. Like I said, you could be champion.
Elliot from New Jersey, talk to us.
Hey, what's going on, man? Y'all hear me?
Loud and clear.
Yeah, Deontay Wilder last night, he did look good, man. He showed me something different with those body shots. He did real good. But I got to agree with a couple people, man. He's very athletic, but he's not really I don't know, man. It's something missing from Deontay Wilder, man. And Dominic Brazil, he looked identical to Chris Areola. I know he's probably – I know you want to say he's in his development stages, but he was an Olympian. And you got to hold those guys to a certain pedigree because they, you know, they had the best amateur. You know, they made it out of all the amateurs technically. You know what I mean? To represent the country. So, I don't know. We can't be too nice to Dominic Brazil. He didn't look very good at all last night. And what was old boy, 5'11"? He wasn't no Mike Tyson or nothing like that. So, he should have looked a lot better than that last night.
Now, they said Casey was 6'2".
Nah, 5'11".
I'll check it out.
5'11", Frank Casey. Yeah, 5'11". That was awful. Another thing, I'm starting to feel like we probably look at boxing a little bit different than training. Because I think some trainers have egos just like the fighters.
And 6 feet on box rec.
Joel Diaz, how? Huh?
6 feet on box rec.
Oh, you're 6 feet. Okay. But it's still, that's still a big difference in height. That's still a big difference.
Oh, I agree.
With real. So, that's all though, bro.
Yo, real quick, Ness. How come nobody's mentioning that eye of Wilder? He got hit, man. That's a breach in his defense, yeah?
I mean, it's a no, fight, dude. It's a fight.
Yeah,
it is a fight, but he never wore a mouse. Be real.
Yeah, but a girl can
walk up. This question. I said it was a great fight. Yeah, I like Wilder.
Anyone can walk up to you and just punch you in the eye, and you can swell up. You can hit somebody one time, their eye swells up, and they can hit you 1,000 to your one. It doesn't mean anything.
All I'm saying is...
You get hit right, you're going to swell up. That's all I'm saying.
You're right. But what I'm saying is I'm surprised nobody's mentioning that. That's all.
You know, I think that it was...
It was a surprise to see him wear it.
It needed a sense of urgency in the fight at some point because you did see Wilder dig deep, and I think that was what Ness was alluding to earlier when he was talking about the desperation. I don't think that's the word he used, but he wanted to get the fight over with. That's what he wanted to do. You know, there was a sense of urgency from Deontay Wilder to finish the fight. And I do think the eye played a part in it. I think that, you know, the eye was starting to close. He might have been getting a little tired. He wanted to put on, you know, for his fans, his hometown fans. And so, you know, that might have gone into it. But I don't think that the eye was anything that, you know, is like a point to look at. Like, go back and you find a big punch that caused that, you know, where he was open. And there were plenty of gaping holes in his performance last night, and I don't think the eye was, you know, any of the major points.
I don't think it was any big deal. I actually thought it was probably like a thumb or something. The way that it swelled up, I don't think that it was an actual punch. Really quick from the hashtag TBB podcast, I wanted to bring this up because Sam Gilley says that before Wilder fought Stiverne, I asked the crew, would they backtrack about the status of Stiverne? Happening now, hashtag TBV. So you guys are flip-floppers because I know they ain't talking about me. And then I asked them, what do you mean? He said, well, now some of y'all are saying Cunningham is better than Stiverne. Rolls on the floor laughing out loud. Boom. You guys are backtracking. That's all.
From when, though?
Does it matter? I'm not going to lie.
From the fight. From
I picked Stiverne to win that fight. I'm not going to lie about it, but I still believe Cunningham's a better fighter than Stiverne.
Yeah. I mean, look at that. That's funny. I'm not going to lie. I didn't even know that, Beeb.
So I picked Stiverne to win that fight.
No wonder.
I did.
No wonder. You've been picking against Wilder. He's proving you wrong.
I haven't been after that fight. I'm a believer, man.
It's the Beeb, baby.
I'm a believer now, man. He's not Tyson Fury, but he's the next best thing.
Yeah, but and look.
Knock Fury out.
No, and we're talking about probably Fury. In super
how
punches.
Is – okay, so B.
Sega Genesis, he will, but not in real life.
So, look, the same question I asked Mario, I'll ask you.
Go ahead,
specifically,
baby.
What does Tyson Fury do if he can't knock out Wilder, which obviously his record indicates he can't knock him out?
He outboxes him. Or he outmuscles him. Or he, puts that 270 pounds on him and wears him down and tires him out.
Hey Mario, look at me. He thinks the guy that got dropped by Cunningham is going to outbox Wilder throwing bombs.
Absolutely.
Bomb squad!
You're putting too much emphasis on this one instance that happened. I mean,
there's
so many things that could explain why he went down, doesn't make him a worse fighter for it.
You want to take that and you want to put it in a capsule, and 50 years from now you want to pull it out. This shit happened, bro. Let it go. What about when Wilder was in those sparring sessions? They showed him getting banged around by David. Hey, does that mean anything? No.
No, because we, at least us, I've definitely always been one of those guys that has stuck with the thing that sparring is sparring, because trainers have taught me that.
Okay, so once you get knocked down, you're trash as a fighter. If you ever get knocked down,
I never said it was trash. I didn't say he was trash because he got knocked down. I said if Cunningham could put him down, Wilder could put him in his
Because he put his hands down.
Wilder
and
put him in his
stuck
grave.
His shin out and was playing with him and dared him to hit him. That was his fault for doing that. But you think he's going to put his hands down in front of Wilder and stick his shin out and dare Wilder to hit him? That's not going to happen.
But that's the point, though. You think that is the only way he can get hit. I'm saying it doesn't matter. He could outbox Wilder for 11 rounds. And in that 12th round, on the 59th second, Wilder just got to drop.
Douglas could stand there for 11 rounds and not even go down. How couldn't Fury?
Yo, now, what you mean not go down? Do you see the punishment that boy suffered? The ref did him a favor.
But he lasted 11 rounds.
Because
I think we're getting too much on this hypothetical stuff, guys. Let's keep it moving. We're never going to get anywhere with this. We're never going to. We'll charge you zero and throw you a kilo. I bet in the week, bro, your pockets
be stuffed like Chipotle burritos. What's up, guys? I thought this was a terrible performance by Wilder. I don't know what fight you guys were watching, but, you know, Mario, you were saying, what did the other guy do? Wilder was eating jabs all night long. It was the same jab that was hitting Wilder, and Wilder had no idea how to defend it. So that left eye that you guys are looking at, that was no thumb. That was repeated jabs landing in Wilder's face. And if you actually look at the third round, it looked nowhere as bad as it looked like in the eighth round. So Wilder, number one, is if you have a good jab, okay, you're going to stop Wilder's offense because the guy has no idea how to defend a jab. The way he defends it is he drops his hands and he goes straight back against the ropes. That's a right hand waiting to happen. Okay, that's number one. He cannot defend a jab. And he does the same thing all over again, the 1-2. So the guys that has been facing, like Stiverne, and these guys are heavy, have heavy feet. They stand in the middle of the ring, and they're not mobile, and they can't move. So they allowed Deontay Wilder to do the 1-2 and just keep circling. But I have Povetkin as a favorite against him. I think Povetkin knocks Wilder out. And, you know, Povetkin does have some slickness to him because he actually moves his head, and he sets up his punches really well. So, and he actually has a jab. With Fury, I mean, I don't think the guys really fought, you know, the competition to say that, you know, how's he going to do against Wilder? I mean, he did get dropped against Cunningham, but let's remember Cunningham's what, like 210 pounds, you know, so how is he going to handle the power of somebody that's 200, you know, 230 pounds hitting him. That's much bigger, too. But, I mean, you know, I just wasn't impressed. I don't know why you guys were impressed. I mean, he fought a guy that's ranked number 40. You know, I mean, he should have just – it should have been a flawless performance, right? He's the champion. But, you know, this guy was able to do this to Wilder. He connected at 30%. 30% of his shots he connected at Wilder. So how is it an impressive performance? I don't understand. I mean, other fighters, you know, they get trashed, you know, for this type of performance and other, you know, other champs in other divisions. And you guys, like, Wilder gets praised. Why? I have no idea, you know.
Well, because for me, anyway, I already said why. I kind of said it, so actually you...
Yeah, AB makes fair points, but there's really nothing else this weekend. I mean,
look who he was fighting, number 40, and he got hit. He got connected 30%, and he was hitting him with jabs all night long.
Yeah, but
I made that point.
That is, yeah, and the problem with that is it's a fight. You're going to get hit.
No, and I see where AB's going with it. You know, at the end of the day, he's absolutely right. You know, there were some things you could take away from the performance, but, you know, you got to look at who he's fighting. That's kind of what I meant about, you know, what was coming back at him. You know, you talk about a jab hitting him, but he was never in any position to be, you know, he was never in any danger, Wilder. And that's really what I meant, is that he was in with a guy that wasn't going to beat him and never was going to beat him. But yeah, AB makes a great point, man. We appreciate that, AB, for you, you know, bringing it back full circle.
And true enough, they said that, you know, I want to see him face Ward next, so let's make that fight happen.
Yeah, well, you know, obviously you didn't watch the telecast, but thanks for calling in, because they made it clear that they don't want Ward, they want Abraham and a rematch with Felix Sturm, which on the telecast they called old. They said, what did they say? They caught, I think he caught Felix Sturm on the way down or something like that. Crazy. I believe this is Randall. What's going on, brother? 813, Tampa. 813.
Yo, yo. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Is it me?
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah, no, that's not Randall. It's Jason Miami. What's going on, fellas?
What's going on?
Talking about Brazil, and I understand what you're saying, Ness. I mean, it's real early. I mean, one of the questions for me is, why is Charles Martin, who's like got 20, 30 fights in, getting that guy Sandez, and Martin, I mean, and Brazil, who's a much newer fighter, is getting somebody like Cassie, who, you know, stumped Areola, probably beat him, and probably you know, and was fighting good against Mansoor until he got cold cocked. I mean, that's what it seems like. I mean, Martin's higher rated, higher in the ratings. He's got, you know, more fights under his belt. Why is there, you know, I mean, it may have been some sort of WO tie or something, but it seemed like Martin should have been fighting Cassie, and Brazil should have been fighting that Sandez guy.
Yeah, but
on the same time with Brazil, though, I mean, yeah, he's developmental, but it's that eye test. It's that, you know, that eye test. And when you take a look at Brazil, I mean, you just don't see it. You just don't see where that future is going to be. You know, I mean, so I understand you got to, you know, take a look at the guys he's coming up. But, I mean, there's something that they saw in the eye test of Mike Tyson when he had only a couple fights. So they said, okay, he's going to be something. There's something that people see in Lomachenko right now, so early with that eye test, you're like, okay, he's going to be something. You know, people can develop. I get that, but there's just such a deficit right now in Brazil that it's so apparent.
Hey, I hear you, James. I will answer that for you, and thank you for calling in. Well, part of your question was, why was Martin fighting who he was fighting in Brazil the other way around? And I think one of my co-hosts mentioned the fact that, you know, Brazil's an Olympian, so they get moved further along quicker because they have that ability, I guess, or they believe they have that ability.
Well, and they've been in that position to be showcased since the very beginning. I mean, who, you know, everybody remembers the first show box card where most of them made their appearance, and so, you know, they've made it a point to keep them all in the, you know, spotlight and capitalize off of that. Being on the U.S. team, you know, that we saw when Errol Spence fought the other day, that they actually showed a list of all the Olympic fighters and what they had done and their combined records. So you're gonna tend to get that with Olympians.
Yep.
Hold up, son. Word.
Yeah, to all the killers and the 100, I got you stuck off the realness. We be the infamous, you heard of us. Official Queensbridge murderers.
Man, listen, what's up, everybody on the panel, man? Listen, man, did you see, man, my boy Deontay Wilder, man? I'm so impressed by him, man. I'm so impressed, you guys, man, with him, man. He made me a believer. Not only did he show the inside game, he improved a lot, man. Yeah, he got hit a little bit, but that's a boxer, man. And Mario, I don't know why you hating on that man. That man shows improvement. What heavyweight, big heavyweight you seen like that fight, like that inside, like that? Angles, in and out, turning around, in and out, angle, turning them, catching uppercuts and all that. You don't see that. You see mostly jabs. And the thing about it is, he's only going to get better, man. That's the thing about it, man. You better do your homework, boy. But, yo, I'm just listening, man. That's all I wanted to say, man. That's our heavyweight, boy. We in the building. Let's go. All right.
Thank you for calling in, QB. You know, he makes a good point. There was improvement. Like, AB can knock on the level of opposition and being hit with a jab.
That's fair.
I mean, everybody, it is fair, but who doesn't get hit with a jab? Could we name a fight where a fighter wasn't hit with a jab?
No.
He meant all night, though.
I don't know about landing them all night. Because
yeah, I didn't see that. I don't know. Maybe I got to go back and watch.
Position, you know, but, you know.
It was early in the fight, and he made the adjustments. And Holyfield was a guy that got hit with a lot of jabs, too. I mean, you could pick up little milts and crannies here and there, nitpick if you want. But at the end of the day, this isn't a video game, and punches are going to get landed here.
Listen,
no,
wait,
this is the world that we live in, that once he beats Povetkin, people are going to say, oh, he didn't do it as good as Vladimir Klitschko did.
Yeah, I mean, and if you look at any punch stats, most guys do get hit on average 25 to 30% in fights. I mean, it just happens.
832, Houston, Texas, holla.
Let's talk about Estrada.
Houston, Texas, with all the background noise and the radio. 210 Texas, talk to me.
Hey, what's up? It's J-Ro.
What up?
Yes! Thank you. Finally. Let's do it. Come on, J-Ro.
Let me talk about the heavyweights first before I move to the main event.
Oh, my God. You're breaking my heart. You're breaking my heart, J-Ro. Damn it.
Hold on.
It's all right. It's all right. It's your call. Go for it.
I would like to talk about water. I was not impressed by Wilder, but I liked some stuff that I saw. His stamina is pretty good. That used to be a big question mark about Wilder, but he has good stamina. The one thing I like about Wilder is he's going to be entertaining. I don't know if he can beat Povetkin, Fury, whatever. I just know it's going to be entertaining. When people talk about, you know, the next star since Floyd's gone, Wilder might have the potential to be that guy. Just because he's an American heavyweight. That's what the Americans like. Heavyweight. He was going to go at you. He's going to fight you. He's going to dig deep. Even if he gets tagged, he's going to come back at you. And with the heavyweights, you can get knocked out and still be a star. Still be the man. Vladimir got knocked out early. You know what I mean? In his prime. And so even if Wilder loses, I think he has the most potential to be the face of boxing. He might not be the best fighter in the sport, but he might be the biggest star. He has that potential. I don't know if he's going to get it, but he has that potential. I'm a fan of Wilder. Like I'm a fan. Like I said, I don't know how good it's going to be. I'm not sure who he can beat in the top 10. I don't think Povetkin is a mismatch. I don't think Fury is a mismatch. I think he has a chance to beat both of them. Only fight right now that's a mismatch for Wilder is Vladimir Klitschko. That's it. But Vladimir Klitschko might be a mismatch with anybody else in the top 10 in the heavyweight division. Well, Wilder, like I said, I wasn't like, oh my God, like very impressed, but I like what I saw. Brazil, I'm surprised they rush him, Brazil. If you look at his 15-16 fight to fight somebody, this guy, I told Ness like that, I was surprised. Because Areola, who's more advanced, fought this guy and couldn't beat him. Wilder, at 15-16 fights, was fighting, you know, guys with losing records, guys who, off TV, who you never even heard of, bums, doing his first 15, 16, 17, 18 fight. Brazil's getting rushed pretty quick, but saying that, I don't think he's going to be that good. He doesn't pass the eye test, but he might surprise, he might get better. Those are the type of fights I feel you need when you're developing to get better. You learn from it. I'm not sure how good he's going to get also, but he could be all right. He could be all right. Like I said, that was a big, big step up. Now with Gallo and Marquez, I was expecting Gallo Estrada to, like, maybe do what Roman did to to Sosa. Like, I was expecting him to be out first two or three rounds. I was surprised how good Tyson Marquez was holding holding on for the first three rounds. He was tagging Gallo. And that makes me worried because I don't think Gallo can beat Chocolatito. He's probably the best fighter flyweight, and Gallo has gotten better since the first fight. Roman has also gotten better since the first fight. Gallo's at a more natural weight class because Gallo had to go down to 108 to fight Roman. He's a legit flyweight, so it's a more natural weight class for Gallo. But he's not going to be Roman. He's not. It was a good fight, but as soon as he started going to the body against Tyson, you saw how old Tyson Marquez is. How much the war just got to him. Because even though he's young, age wise, he's like 28, 27. Ring age, Tyson Marquez is like 41, 40. Because he's been in so many wars, and Gallo is a skillful fighter, elite fighter, might be the best Mexican fighter in the world right now, that includes Canelo, that includes Leo Santa Cruz, but I think Roman is on another level. I think Roman is special, and that's all I got to say about that one. What do you think about this fight, Mario?
Well, I'm glad that, first of all, man, you made all the points, and now Ness is going to shit on me after we let you go because you agreed with all his points. But, yeah, I agree with you, man. Marquez surprised the hell out of me. And thank you so much for mentioning that because I don't think I did mention that Marquez surprised. But it wasn't until Estrada went to the body that Marquez showed his age. And even though the ref probably let a few too many knockdowns go, it's not that I'm glad that he did that, but it was impressive to see the heroics of Marquez and really the embodiment of the flyweight division. It's not just Marquez. Those guys do that. They get up. They continue to fight. You know, they have a heart that I just don't think exists to that level in any other division. And I'm not trying to say that everyone's weaker in all the other divisions. Not at all. I'm simply saying that you tend to see better fights, guys with more heart, and more action at that division and lower and slightly higher than any other divisions. And that's my only point. But, I don't think it's just the best flyweight fight. I think it's the best fight in all of boxing. I think Chocolatito and Estrada is the best fight in boxing right now. People are talking about Inyu, and it's a good fight, but it's just not there yet. You know, you talked about the inactivity, J-Ro, and that's the biggest thing, I think, for Inyu. And so I can't wait. It has to happen. It has to.
I think that the biggest thing for Inyu is that we haven't been able to see him.
Exactly.
At least Estrada, you know, we were told about this and we were able to tell our listeners he's on beIN Sports, but there's still people that haven't seen him. I think that before he goes into a Chocolatito fight, they need to put him on HBO or a sister network, True TV, something, you know, but start introducing him because – I mean, how many people actually watched that yesterday? Maybe 50, 60,000?
Hey, I didn't even know he was fighting.
True. No, it's a good point. It's a good point.
And here's the thing, right? Because Gallo has kind of pissed me off this year because he's kind of been procrastinating. they were talking about putting this fight, the Estrada Marquez fight, on the undercard of Bradley, when Bradley fought, who was it, Marquez? Was it Marquez, right? They was talking about putting this fight as an HBO headliner, because HBO is backing the flyweights. I know Robbie said, you know, the problem was that the networks were not interested in the smaller weight class, but now they are. Tucolatito made them interested in the smaller weight class. So HBO is backing up this division, and HBO did offer the fight to put it on the undercard. Gallo said no. Gallo was like, I'm gonna need more time or whatever. And I thought that was like a missed opportunity, because this fight should have happened in July. I honestly feel it should be Roman and Gallo right now, happening in October or November. But we'll see the big fight. Sanford told me that they're looking at a rematch with Chocolatito, maybe in May or June. That is, if Roman beats Villoria in October, and Roman might fight in Japan on December, January. And in fact, we knew, he's just young. He's still young. He's 22 years old. He isn't going anywhere. He only has like 8 fights. Even though he beat the hell out of Narvaez for 2 rounds, like destroyed him. Which, again, you saw that from Naoya Inoue. That's something I expected to see from Gallo Estrada. That's something I still haven't seen from Gallo Estrada. Just go out there and bulldozer a guy, you know, for 2 or 3 rounds. You see that from Inoue. You see that from Roman. You don't see that from Gallo.
And great point.
It kind of worries me a little bit when he fights Roman. But Inoue is going to be there at 115. The fight right now is Roman and Gallo at 112. And then, you know, the winner can move up and, Naoya Inoue will be there. There's no rush for that fight.
Yeah, you said that yesterday. I completely agree with you that he's going to be there, and that makes perfect sense. But I'm glad to hear that you talked to him, and they're targeting at least a time frame. So that's good.
J-Ro, we're going to keep it moving, brother. Thanks for calling in. On the hashtag TBV podcast, we got that was the last caller. He wasn't ready. But we got Bayamong93PR. At Bayamong93PR says, how do you guys rate Deontay Wilder's chin from what you all have seen so far? No hypotheticals, guys. What
better than
seen so far?
Better than advertised, because I think he's gotten a lot of slack for it, and I think it's better than what a lot of people are giving it credit for. And Stavern, to his credit, does have some power. And he did hit Wilder, and Wilder took the shots very well. This guy didn't land any power shots, but he landed some good jabs, and it didn't deter Wilder from coming forward. So I think he's a durable guy. I think he's a strong guy, and I think he's very well conditioned.
Yeah, that I agree pretty much with Beeb. And if you go back to some of the things that the callers were saying about who was it? I think it was AB that talked about. Not the intensity, but he just continued to go forward. He continued to do things that surprised Wilder, I think, surprised all of us, really.
Long distance here, somewhere in the United Kingdom, with the radio playing in the background. Mad Men. All right. Let me see. We got N.O.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you a young fella, and he comes from the Magnolia.
That was awesome. That's the first time I heard that.
What up? What up?
What's up? Well, what's up, Ned? What's up, Robbie? What's up, Mario? You know what I'm saying? Everybody on the panel, you dead. Look, man, I'm impressed with old Wilder, bro. I gotta say that, man. I'm impressed with him. He showed me he can adjust when he faced adversity. You know what I'm saying? He was getting hit with the jab the first 4 rounds. Then after that, he made an adjustment. You know what I'm saying? He got on the inside. He started going to the body. He started pumping the jab, coming with some uppercuts, coming with a couple of, you know what I'm saying, lead uppercuts. I like what I saw. He got hit with the jab, but he adjusted after the 4 rounds. To me, I don't think he got hit all night with it. And then, as long as he didn't get hit with nothing behind the jab, I mean, what more are you looking for? I was impressed with him. He did what he had to do. He went some rounds, and he got that guy out of there, and I like his stamina. Come on, man, man. He a heavyweight, man. He got stamina like a welterweight, man. You got to give him something for that. You know what I'm saying? And, I heard on Kathy Duva, she was saying something about Ward and Kovalev might be going down for sure. So HBO for to be talking with Ward, and they're for to be setting up some type of deal for a couple of fights. And I guess the Kovalev fight, that's the selling point. Y'all heard anything about that?
I have not heard anything about that.
Not at all. Not even a little bit.
Yeah, that's what I heard. It's supposed to be going now, man. They talking with Ward, right? But it, I guess it. I heard she was talking with Rock Nation. I don't mean she was talking with Ward. She talked with Rock Nation. I heard they on good terms, and they're supposed to be trying to put something together. If it's gonna happen or not, I don't know for sure. I thought y'all might have heard about it. But Ward might want to wait for Triple G. I don't know. Y'all don't nobody know what Ward's doing right now. He ain't saying nothing. And Virgil Hunter, he ain't really clear on what's going on either. It's just like he might go up, might not. I don't know what he's. I hope he do go up, man, because waiting on Triple G, he got a couple of fights ahead of him, man. That might be 2017. Waiting on Triple G. You know what I'm saying? In the midst of all that, he can fight the girl, or he can go ahead and fight Kovalev, or you know what I'm saying? Better be somebody, but no, better be with Haymon, so that can't happen either. I don't know. What y'all think? What y'all think he needs to do?
Well, I will say that I actually have a little bit of insider information on this, and I can't say what I know, but I'm just going to put it to you like this. I don't even think that the camp knows where they're going to go. I think that this year is based on getting back in the ring, and if he indeed does fight in November on the card, on the Cotto card, which, you know, everyone... seems to believe he is going to, it is probably going to end up being another catchweight. I don't think there was any urgency whatsoever this year to make a decision to go up or down. I think that he's going to continue fighting at a comfortable weight so that he can make a decision for the beginning of next year. But until he fights a big fighter, until there's a huge opportunity in front of him worth money, I think he's going to let that be his decision. You know, if it was going to be Golovkin, I think he would have worked to go down. If it was going to be Kovalev, I think he's going to work to go up. But I don't even think the camp is sure at this point where they're going to continue to compete.
Well, I will say about Beterbiev and those possibilities. Beterbiev didn't even take a fight with Sullivan Barrera because he wants to fight in Canada, which rightfully so. He is more known than Barrera and draws at least in Canada. But Barrera has obviously legal issues that won't allow him to travel to Canada in time, so that fight can't be made. But I'm just saying that to say that, you know, if they can't even do a Barrera fight, how are they going to do a Ward fight? But let's get to some other callers here. We got Columbus, Ohio, 614. Talk to us. Who's this?
Yeah, Jay Will from Columbus, Ohio, man. I guess I'm just going to holler. I guess I'm going to start with the heavyweights, Deontay Wilder. Now, honestly, I think I'm kind of – I guess I'm going to kind of combine with, I guess, A.B. and Jay Rose saying, I guess, put it all in one comment. As far as the whole – I guess start with the whole A.B. side. I mean, just looking at Deontay Wilder, if you've been watching boxing for a while, if you know what a good boxer actually looks like, he doesn't – like, to the naked eye, doesn't really represent that. So a lot of the things he does doesn't look smooth and things like that, I guess I would say. I mean, it just doesn't look good to the naked eye. But, and as far as y'all say he's been improving, which he has. He's improved, but, I mean, like AB said, for the guy to, and even, I guess, the NO caller even said, the first four, I think even five rounds, that jab was messing with him. And it wasn't nothing, it wasn't a quick or, you know, super crispy jab. It was just a jab from a big heavyweight. And he couldn't really, really do with it the first couple of rounds except for either get hit with it or go straight back in a straight line, which is, I mean, it's one thing to say, all right, somebody was getting hit with a jab. And, like, when you say things after a caller hangs up, like, everybody gets hit with a jab. You know, that's kind of dumbing down what A.B. said. A.B. ain't saying, well, he got hit with a jab. But like, it was the fact that he kept getting hit with a jab, and he couldn't do nothing really with it. He didn't have any type of technical way to solve getting hit with a jab instead of just going back in a straight line, which is technically the opposite thing you want to do. So, I mean, I guess I would start with that. I would, you know, say with that, I guess what AB said. But even with that being said, what J. Rowe said, even with that being said, I like the guy. He's entertaining. I mean, he's fun to watch. I also agree with J. Rowe said he might be a good candidate to be the next cash cow because, you know, he's an American heavyweight and he gives the people what they want, which is knockouts. So I think you can't just, you don't have to, I guess, pick a side of the line, like either he looks bad and I don't think he's all that, or I like the guy and I think he's really improving. It's a little bit of everything with that guy. You just got to accept him for what he is. And I think that just goes to show how trashy the heavyweight talent has gotten since I would say the Lennox Lewis and Evander Holyfield, and when those guys were in their prime, those guys either were Olympians or had Olympic aspirations. You know what I'm saying? That's why they have fundamental skills. Even as big guys, they were still fundamentally sound in pretty much everything they did. And I think the good thing for Wilder is that there is no more slick fighters. Y'all was trying to say, who's a slick fighter? Saverna slick. Those guys ain't slick. They, like I think Beeb said, they big guys on their feet. They don't move. They don't really slip. They really don't move their head. They get hit with pretty much almost every other punch that's thrown at them.
Caller.
So I think the last...
What about Mike Perez? We got some hashtag TBV podcast tweets saying Mike Perez is a very slick heavyweight, and they wanted to correct Beeb on that.
But he's not in the upper echelon right now, so he's not even somebody to even really talk about.
Hey, yeah, that's a good point.
I love that you said
that. Let's be honest.
Hey, listen, we're gonna get to some other callers. J. Will, thanks for calling in, brother.
Good
Corey
call.
Corey from VA, you're up.
Can you hear me?
Loud and clear. The tornado just finished.
Listen, man. I watched the fights this weekend. No crow needed. I know for a fact that this fight coming up with Amir Mansour, I got upset written all over it. That undefeated fighter, he's another Seth Mitchell. He's a fucking football player. He's not a boxer. He got a nice physique. Mansoor's a little smaller than him. But I got Mansoor knocking him out by seventh round TKO.
Just to inform our listeners, you're talking about the Gerald Washington fight that's going to be happening on PBC. I think Toe to Toe Tuesdays. It's happening October 13th versus Amir Mansoor.
Yeah, that's the fight I'm talking about. That's the fight to watch out for.
Well, all right, Corey, I'm that's all you got.
And Anui, y'all was talking about Anui. I think Anui is ready for Chocolate Latito or whatever his name is. I think Anui is ready. He's young. He's only 22, 23. But I got him. I got Anui stopping Chocolate Latito. I got him stopping.
Wow. That's it. He's done.
I'm telling y'all. Y'all keep sleeping on Anui, man. He's the truth. I was talking about him two shows ago, and now y'all start talking about him.
Yeah, we haven't talked about him because he hasn't been fighting. What are you talking about? We can't talk about a dude who ain't fighting. Come on.
No, that's why. Hey, that's why Corey calling in today to talk about Amir Mansour. So when we preview the show, I was talking about Mansour two shows ago.
Yo, you're talking about a new, like, because he ain't been fighting. He ain't been fighting.
Deontay Wilder fight. I think Deontay Wilder, you know what I'm saying, he got hit, you know what I mean, he got a halfway decent chin. It's just like his legs, I don't know if they're going to hold up with big punches like Povetkin. You know what I'm saying, Povetkin could knock Deontay Wilder out. That's a dangerous fight. So, for all y'all saying that about the Marco Hunt fight, I think Povetkin looks different, his physique is different, everything's different about him, man. So I can't even judge him on that fight. And, yeah, so and then on the other fight, the Brazil fight, Brazil is definitely getting set up to get destroyed by some one of these nice heavyweights out here. Because what I seen Saturday night didn't show me anything.
He looked awful against a nobody, against a guy that Mansoor knocked out in 10 rounds. Cold cock knocked out, not just a, oh, I can't beat the count. This dude was knocked out till he couldn't even. He had a Manny Pacquiao knockout. Yeah.
Yeah, that was a fight of the year.
That's all I got to say. I ain't talking greasy today. You know what I mean? So, Robbie, you good? You know what I mean? You ain't got to worry about me today. It's a Sunday, and I'm going to be good today. You know what I mean?
All right, Corey. Thanks for calling in.
Hey, real quick before. Oh, my bad. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say he's right. That knockout, Amir Mansoor with Fred Casey, was horrific. I mean, it was an uppercut. And he really flattened Casey.
No, I remember. I remember clearly. Real quick, I do want to mention that one fight that was on PBC last night that they didn't show on TV, but if you are active at all on Facebook or Twitter, you know, and you're a boxing fan, then you saw it, and that was Mario Barrios. I wanted to talk a little bit about him just briefly. He's a really good kid, solid prospect out of the San Antonio area. He was a good amateur, very, very talented, really big kid. If you haven't gotten the chance, just go. The footage is floating around there somewhere. Mario Barrios scored a first-round knockout, I believe it was. It was a devastating knockout. I just want to mention that, you know, keep an eye on the kid. He's very good. He's racking up some highlight reel stoppages. And if you didn't get a chance to see it, I will tweet a link, or I'll just put the video up on my Twitter here in after the show, and you can get a chance to go look at it. And I just don't want y'all to sleep on that kid. He's very talented.
Yeah, he had that first-round knockout. A lot of people were talking about it on my timeline there. We got a couple other callers here. Randall from Tampa, talk to us.
Hey, what's going on? This is Randall.
That's what I said.
Hello? Oh, every time you come to me, it meet up. But, hey, I just want to say about Wilder, you know, I was real impressed with him. Going back to when he fought Severn, I came on here and talked a lot of shit about the boy. And ever since then, I have noticed his improvement. I like the way how he tucked his elbows in and really threw them inside punches, because before he was real wide throwing those hooks and stuff. So he does some higher level boxing skills in the ring, but he hasn't mastered all of the basics. You know, him pulling straight back, keeping his hands down, those things that's going to come back to hurt him. We can see that, you know, it's going to come back to hurt him. But the biggest problem that I think Wilder has is that I think he has potential to be the man in the heavyweight division. I think the two things that hurt him is, one, he didn't pick up boxing early enough, so he may not never be as refined as we want him to be as a fighter. And number two, I think they fed him bombs too long. Now he has that belt, and we see him improving every fight, but he's not going to have the time to defend that belt and keep on improving, because now he got to fend off these top challenges. So those are two things that I don't think that's going to hinder Wilder from getting to his best potential. What you think about that?
Well, Randall, you know, it's like you say, he's going to have to prove it on the job, but I think that he's doing that. And you know, it's going to probably take another type of Stavern-Povetkin fight to convince a few more of you. There's still going to be very many, you know, that aren't convinced. I'm going to go to this long-distance caller. Oh, he dropped off. Not my fault, brother, because I went to you before and you ain't answer. You know, tweeting me. What could I do? You got to answer when we go to you. Let me see. We got Compa. Talk to me.
Hey, yo, what's up, Boxing Voice? What's Gucci? Hey, what's up, man? How's it going, Ness? Everybody, Mario, Beeb, James, Robbie, Smurda, what up?
Robbie Smurda, I love it. I love it.
Hey, man, I like my boy Deontay. You know, he got the win. He looked all right, but I want to see him fight Areola. You know, just to see. I think that'll be another test for him. If Areola comes in shape and gets his shit together, I think he'll give Deontay a good fight. And fuck, man, my boy Tyson Marquez, man, he has to retire, man. He's been getting knocked out in a lot of his last fights, and I don't think that's cool. But What else was I gonna say? What's up with this weekend, baby? Matisse, Pastor, Broner, Khabib, or what's that other guy's name? That's gonna be a good fight, man.
We got a lot. We got a lot to talk about.
Ness knows how to pronounce his name.
Tupac. Tupac is the greatest, baby. West Side, Tupac, baby. Let's go.
Well, for y'all wondering about the Matisse Postal, the show is Thursday, and we'll get into that Thursday, so we're not going to jump the gun. However, we do have a treat for y'all. I'm not going to spoil it, but we do have a segment towards the end of the show that we're going to get into, and y'all are going to enjoy it, and it has specifically to do with next weekend's fight.
Yeah, let's segue into some of these headlines, because there's a couple of headlines I want to mention out there that are big, big headlines. Amir Khan and Manny Pacquiao in talks for a Las Vegas showdown. Aram revealed that there are talks ongoing between both of these camps. This is great news. Great news. You know, all I want is a world of unity and equality. And if Aram and Haymon could get it together and do business, that's great for me. And I quote, "We are planning for Manny Pacquiao to fight at the end of February or at the latest, the first 2 weeks in April," Aram told the Sunday Telegraph. "March is out of the question because of big college basketball tournaments in the United States that gets all the ink at the time. I'm in the process of having negotiations with Amir Khan's uncle and his lawyer, Robert Davis, and those negotiations are ongoing. I know that there was a report that Khan was coming here to make the deal with us, with Ruslan Pavotnikov, but he ensured me that was not the case. I'm not necessarily saying that negotiations will be successful, although I believe that everybody is negotiating in good faith while those negotiations are ongoing. I am not going to discuss any other opponents for Manny Pacquiao. So until Khan is not an option, no one else is an option. There is a possibility that it could happen in Dubai, but I think it's more likely it will be in Las Vegas. Khan's trainer Virgil Hunter, however, was warned the Bolton fighter that he needs to spend more time in the gym if he is to fulfill his talent. If he's serious about your craft and serious about making a mark on the sport and being great, then it's just a matter of time before lots of that traveling backfires on you and there's only so much I can do for you," Hunter said. So Virgil Hunter not happy that Amir Khan is trying to save the world going up and down to Somalia on his PR campaign.
Well, he makes a very, very fair point. I mean, some people can look at what Virgil's saying as kind of an out, but I don't take it that way at all. I think Virgil Hunter is being honest, and it's honesty time for Amir. You know, Amir Khan has spent so much time focused on the Mayweather fight that he's forgotten to actually fight. He's forgotten to stay busy. Amir Khan has not capped. He is not as good as he could be. All right, Amir Khan can be much better than he is. But you don't get that way by staying inactive, by not being in the gym. You know, and look, for all I know, Amir Khan is finding some time, but it's not enough. Okay, he should be having mini camps, you know, not to peak, but to be staying in shape and to be getting ready and to be getting better. With the biggest fight possibly coming on the horizon for Amir Khan, he needs to buckle down. He needs to get serious about boxing, and he needs to redeem himself. He has not done anything as a welterweight, and it is time because he can be the best welterweight in the division, and it's only going to be up to him. If he loses to Manny Pacquiao, it will absolutely be because of the things that have been going on over the last couple of years as opposed to what happens in those camps in the couple months.
Well, I guess the only thing I want to add to that, then I thought maybe one of those guys was going to say something. I'll add this to Mario. You know, I know that you're the resident Amir Khan defender. While I believe he's a pretender, I'm going to say he really needs to decide how long he's willing to wait for Manny Pacquiao and these negotiations to happen. Again, it's feeling like that winner when he was waiting on Mayweather and he avoided the Devin Alexander fight. And right now, we got a lot of welterweights in that PBC realm that are available. And this is strategic ducking to me. This is ducking all powerful punchers in order to lose versus a guy that it's okay to lose with. See, because when you lose to Manny Pacquiao, nobody writes you off. But if you lose to Keith Thurman, maybe. If you lose to Sean Porter, maybe. If you lose to Danny Garcia, maybe. But
strong words, strong words.
I'm just saying. I don't want him to wait on this fight. It doesn't happen. Then here we are in April, and he still hasn't fought. Robbie,
go ahead, Robbie.
Yeah. I wanted to jump in here for a minute. I believe Amir Khan is a talented fighter, but he's allowing his ego to dictate what he wants in his career. The best way to get some of these fights is to actually step in the ring with some of these people, have a Danny Garcia rematch, have a Keith Thurman fight a Sean Porter. Fight some of these people and prove that you're worthy of the big fight that you want to have. The longer you sit around and wait for Manny Pacquiao to decide when he's going to fight you, you're going to be pulling an Andre Ward and allowing your career to go to pass you by. It's more important to be in the ring and worry about what you do in the ring instead of what you're doing outside the ring.
I agree. I just don't want the guy to let time pass him by again, and then he didn't fight all but once this year. Speaking of fighting, I am not pleased with this matchup at all. Jermell Charlo is going to be facing veteran Josamine Al-Klein. Whatever, man. This dude's lost to more guys than probably anyone in the junior middleweight division. It's a hometown fight for Charlo. I don't even know what's going on. Like, you know, if I were Jermell, I would be upset for one reason and one reason only. My other brother, who's fought less opposition than I have, he didn't fight Gabe Rosado. He didn't fight Harry Yogi. He ain't fight nobody that Jermell fought and got a title shot and now is a champion. And I'm still fighting Joseem Al-Klein, man, get out of this.
I think Joakim Al-Sin, didn't he have a draw or something with David
man,
Lemieux?
This dude's been knocked out by every... No, he beat Lemieux.
Oh, he beat Lemieux, right? Yeah. I apologize. That's correct. So I'm saying, I don't know. This guy's going to be a good test.
He also got knocked out by a lot of people after beating Lemieux, I believe.
Like, but he get him knocked out by Andy Lee, right?
That Lemieux win was probably a fluke.
Wait, who did he get knocked out by? He got knocked out by somebody.
By everybody.
Macklin, right?
Macklin
knocked
him out
by Alfredo Angulo. He got knocked out by Daniel Santos. Man, he got knocked out by Brian Rose. Man, this is...
What was that last knockout? What was that last knockout, Ness?
Brian Rose.
Who's before that?
Matthew Macklin.
That's the one I'm thinking. That was dirty. Yeah, I don't even know what to call it.
Jermell might not even knock him out.
Do you call it a stay busy fight? What do you call this?
That's what you call it.
You can't call this a stay busy because it's a headline and it doesn't make sense, dude. It's
I know. That's what I'm saying.
Side backwards. Step backwards.
But unfortunately, like, some of these stay busy fights are being on main events. They're being listed.
Exactly. So. And that's Beep's point. Is it's a stay busy fight because it's a stay busy fight. But then Ness's point is that you can't call it a stay busy fight when he's headlining in this situation.
It's different
for Andre Ward, who was coming back from an extensive layoff was in trouble, you know, from a legal standpoint, or not in trouble, but you know what I'm trying to say, in a sticky situation.
Tough situation.
Where he came back to a fair and appropriate matchup. But with this, I don't know, man. This feels like a step back.
Yo, listen to Charlo. This is a good fight against a former world champion. He's experienced. He's been in the ring with multiple world champions. I'm not taking anything away from him, but Houston is my hometown, and I've been anticipating another fight here, and I'm ready to go. I'm going to put on a great show. I'll decline to watch this Al Klein fight because he's 30 fucking nine. Man, let's move on, man. Let's get to some calls. I'm sorry, Robbie. Go ahead. This dude is out of control. You know, because I defend these guys, and this is crazy. Like, I love the Charlos, but this is bullshit right now. I mean, I've been waiting for him to. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Rob. I'm just frustrated.
Yeah. No, this is basically a PPE sparring session is what this is going to turn out to be. And how in the world – see, the people that criticize the PBC, this is something that the people are going to criticize. If this is main event on one of the TV networks, people are going to shit all over this because it's not top-level competition. He's fighting somebody that's 39 years old.
Well, it's NBC Sports Net, to be fair, so that's like the equivalent of under an ESPN.
Yeah, I know, but still –
I mean, it is what it is. Listen, if you ain't giving shit to Andy Ruiz versus Joel Godfrey, you got to understand this is no different than that. This is the same, except for the fact that Charlo is too far along to be having this type of fight unless he was coming off a big fight his last fight. But this is not Robert Guerrero, Aaron Martinez, Robert Guerrero coming off the Thurman fight. This is just Charlo staying busy. Robbie, give me a minute. Let me get to some of these Skype people. They've been waiting forever. Scorsese, talk to me.
Are you game?
Why you always say that? I mean,
that's his catchphrase. That's his catchphrase.
If you hear me, I hear you.
Yo, that's his catchphrase. Don't listen to him, Scorsese.
But yeah, y'all can talk about Khan and Pacquiao all you want, but I'm not finna go there. I'm gonna talk about Deontay, the Bronze Bomber.
How did we know? How did we know?
He about to put the blanket over every division. They gonna get that Pernell Whitaker treatment. I'm sorry, Pernell had to happen to you. They gonna get outshined. It's not gonna be no light for them. If you gonna beat them, you gonna beat them now, or you ain't gonna never beat them. That's why they rushing them, cause they want to see them beat, cause they know they see them getting better every time he get in the ring. I felt what's his name? Duopie? Let's call him Doopy. I felt like Doopy was better than Wilder in about every area of the game except for power and speed. So how do I not give him credit when I go on there and see him taking the angles, him dropping the body shots? And he didn't drop a lot in this, but you look at his body, then look at Paulie body versus Danny, and they look the same. He hit that man in the body. He looked at him like, yeah, you didn't know I was going to do that to your ass, did you? Like, he getting 20% better every time he get in the ring. And Randall was right, man. They fed him bombs too long. But that's going to make it even more impressive when you start hearing him mention with, oh, he would have beat Ali. Ali never faced nobody like Wilder. That's going to make it even more impressive. That's what made Sonny Liston impressive. He wasn't no damn gold medalist. He wasn't no amateur. He just came in and knocked out Floyd Patterson's ass. So am I right or wrong here? Like, that's going to make it more impressive when you see this dude who ain't supposed to be doing this. He a freak of nature. It's his show. It's the Bomb Squad show. That's what it is. And, don't put him on Showtime no more. He need to be on NBC, ESPN for everybody can see. It's the Bomb Squad show. BJ Flores, it's amazing to me that he do a better job on the microphone than Sugar Ray Leonard because he's nowhere near the fighter. But this is why Doopy stayed along long enough. Wilder can't land the shot that you can't see yet. That's why he stayed around that long. He got him out of there. But anyway, he can't land that shot. But I seen him try to go over the top with the right hand. I seen him try to roll a right hand and land that shot that you weren't prepared for just yet. And when he started doing that without having to think about that, he getting even better. And Povetkin going to get this work, man. Loaded luck style, he going to get that work. If he can't hit Huck going backwards, what he going to do hitting a 6-7 going backwards? He pulling out with that willow tree defense, swinging his arms and shit. You can't hit that. That boy is he finna be the truth, man. That's how I see it.
Bomb Squad!
The truth. I mean, if you going to beat him, you going to beat him now. I'm impressed, man. I had a casual fan on my phone. And one more point, I'm going to get up out of here about how he improving. You could say he was a bum. Dude was a bum, and I don't agree with you. But they could say he was a bum. But, okay, he been fighting bums, and you ain't never seen him take an angle on nobody, right? Remember when Deontay Wilder was finna knock Stavern out and Stavern tackled him? Y'all remember that?
Mm-hmm.
We remember.
I remember.
Beep remembers more than me, though.
You know why he got tackled in that when he was trying to finish him? He got tackled because he never took an angle and said, Stavern, you just can't walk into me. I mean, that's why he done it. Now you see him almost able to finish. Now, when he was finishing and he was taking the angle, he should have been dropping something to the body. That's the only thing he wasn't doing right. He would have got him out of that. And as far as his stamina, man, this dude got better stamina than a welterweight. He tried to finish dude 3 times and never shot his low. He never pulled the Triple G versus Willie Monroe and had to get beat up for 2 rounds. That's it, man. That's the new dude. It's a new day, man. I'm impressed.
You should end it there. You should end it there while you hot. I mean, right now that was a good ending.
I'm done.
Listen,
I think he wants to talk about Estrada Marquez.
I want to remind everybody about these 2 Triple G tickets since Scorsese brought them up. We got these 2 Triple G tickets. You can win them absolutely free. All you got to do is head on over to theboxingvoice.com and click on our subscribe email list and join our email list absolutely free. You win these 2 tickets, Madison Square Garden, live on pay-per-view, October 17th, Gennady Golovkin versus David Lemieux. And I also want to remind everyone and encourage everyone to continue to use our Amazon link. Just head on over to theboxingvoice.com/affiliate sponsors. Click on that link. Bookmark that link. Make that link your you know, do your Valentine shopping there. We got Christmas coming up. Get your Halloween candy. Help a brother out. Keep these lights on. I'm telling you. Georgie Porgy, bless us.
You sound far, Georgie.
Listen, bro. Let me get on here before you call me out. First of all, I'm proud of Mario. I'm proud of B standing up to fucking ass. God damn, it wouldn't be for them, man, to see another fucking cheerleading on him and shit. Can be happy with that. These fighting at 40 in a fucking main event. And you ain't seen no problem with that. Do land 30% of the punches, you just want to dismiss those fucking numbers. Doggy, he should took that dude out on the 4th round, the top, the longest. 4th round over with. But nah, you got an eye on him and she lead the whole thing. What the fuck, Ness? Cut that shit out, man. That shit wasn't even competition. You talking about...
Hey, Georgie. Who's knocked out Dung Hoppus? Who's knocked him out before? So shut the fuck up then. Shut the fuck up then. Why does Wilder gotta knock him out in 5 if nobody's ever knocked him out? Why? If nobody's knocked him out, why does Wilder gotta do it in 5?
That's not competition, bro. Dude's getting beat since the 1st round.
Bomb squad!
What round did you give it to the French dude? What round he won? Not even one. That shit wasn't competition going in. And the other Brazil dude, that's another piece of shit. All these niggas, they're just big. Big dudes. When you get
why you watched it?
Nigga, because I'm trying to fucking let you know what's good instead of
but, being... No, but why you watched it? Why did you watch it? Why?
And you got to know what mafia's going on, bro. That's why.
I thought that was the fight that entertained you, Georgie.
Listen, I don't fuck ugly bitches. You're an idiot if you watching something you don't like.
Yes, you do.
You fucking insane.
Listen, man, let me... What's up with that crow last week? Did you eat your crow from last week?
I mean, the only one that deserves crow is someone that's calling in, asking someone to knock someone out in 5 rounds when he's never been knocked out before. You setting a standard for Deontay Wilder at 5 rounds. Why? You're so impressed with him.
Dude, you must really think...
Hey, Beeb, how highly does he think of Wilder that he thinks Wilder should have got him out in 5 rounds?
Yeah, man, I mean...
Oh, so you're really the PBC cheerleader. You're really the Wilder cheerleader, huh? You're the one that loves Wilder because you want him to do it in 5 rounds.
That you didn't even fought. I didn't even want to watch that shit because I already know the outcome.
Oh, you didn't want to watch it, but you watched it.
How many people?
But you watched it.
The French.
But didn't you watch it?
How many picked the French dude to win last week? Not even one caller. Not the worst thing I saw in the fucking planet alive.
Hey, Georgie, let me ask you something. How many people picked Joel Godfrey versus Andy Ruiz last Thursday? How many people picked Tyson Marquez versus Estrada last Thursday? Shut up!
This fight
fight and that fight and that fight. This is the fight we're watching. This is what we're talking about.
The title of the show says Juan Francisco Estrada. How many people picked Tyson Marquez? Genius.
Who's talking about that fight?
Exactly. My point is, it's another fight on another network, another promoter, and it doesn't matter that it was one-sided because you are just a dick rider. That's what you are. You got a fucking dick in between your legs. You saddled up, and you just riding down the fucking road with your fucking ponytail swinging in the air, with your fucking balding head in the top front. You fucking, man, this guy, he's...
All I'm saying, the same way you are disappointed with the Charlo fight, you should be disappointed in all these fucking Haymon fucking setup.
Yo, you obviously not disappointed. Listen. Every week you call in to talk about it because you love it. You love it. You love it.
Here, bro. When fucking
I thought you was excited, Georgia.
He fought the stripper. That fucking his
Kid
name.
Kid Chocolate.
When he fought the stripper. He almost killed the dude. You even said it, that shit was a mismatch. So we're getting tired of seeing this shit. There's competition out there. Tell these niggas to put these matches on, bro. I don't want to see that shit on main event. You think that's a main event? I don't give a fuck if it's free. That make no sense anyway, bro. Anyway, great show. Thumbs up.
I just don't understand how someone says.
Yo, did you hear what he said?
No.
Great show, thumbs up.
Great show, thumbs up.
Yeah, he's weird. Out.
Yo, yeah. He's so yeah, but it's funny
but listen,
though.
But listen, it's exactly what I'm saying. Look, he talks all this shit that we dick ride, and then he says thumbs up. He talks all this shit that the fights are bad, but he's watching them. I mean, the guy's insane. You gotta leave him alone.
Nah,
that's
he baited you. I think he's trolling now, and he baited you.
Nah, he is a troll. That's about it. 985, you're live.
That 985 never comes through.
All right. 561. I think this is 561 from Twitter, too. Let me see his name on Twitter. Is Worldwide Boxing. What's up?
Yo, what up, guys?
What's going on?
Going on?
Yo, first time caller.
Ding, ding, ding.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his professional debut.
It's Matt from Florida. Yo, guys, I wanted to talk about the PBC cards. I'll say it first and foremost, I'm a huge Wilder fan. You know, I love the heavyweight division. I love Wilder. And, I mean, he's getting a lot of hate, you know. I mean, not that Duapo, he's never been knocked out. He never been knocked down in a fight before. He never touched the canvas. He was in with the dude that just knocked out Price. And, you know, he went 12 rounds with him. So, I mean, I don't know, you know, and I mean, Brazil, I mean, I thought Brazil, I mean, in his last fight against that Cuban dude, forget his name, but I thought he looked stiff in that fight until he landed a big shot. So, I mean, it really didn't surprise me that Cassie, like, gave him some problems, you know. But I mean, why do you guys answer Georgie Forge every week, man? That dude is just, like, always pissed, man.
Like, let me tell you, I already boycotted him. I already boycotted him, but the panel is weak. They want me to keep bringing him on week after week.
You engaged him. He can just get his shit off, and then you engaged him. He suckered you in. Don't get mad.
He's an imbecile.
He fucking got you, bro.
Well, unfortunately, we have to take everybody's calls that call in.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You can't. Yeah, you can't be biased. But let's see. What else? I mean, did you guys see a Tarek Chisora fight on like the undercard of like Chuninoff, I think?
No, I didn't even know.
Yo, he looked terrible. He went like 8 rounds with this dude who was just like ass. Like, it was like the worst thing.
Yeah, but
I've
that's
ever
my
seen.
Point to be. Chisora has always been nothing but a loser. All he do is lose, no matter what.
And I mean, you guys are talking like Tyson Fury. Tyson Fury, when he knocked out Cunningham, was down on like 2 or 3 cards, I think. He was like.
And he was down on a canvas, too.
And if you look back, I think Fury got floored by another dude, like, few fights before that, who was also small. So, like, I mean,
that was a slip.
I don't know, like, I don't know how Fury's chin doesn't get called out more than Wilder's. Like,
he's a great fighter.
I think he got floored once by some dude, but...
That just proves how good Cunningham is.
Yeah, I mean, but...
Cunningham's a world-ranked fighter.
The first guy to, like, knock out Cunningham, so that's impressive, but... I mean, what was I going to say? I mean, I don't see how you guys could, like, favor Povetkin over Wilder. If you watch that Povetkin-Klitschko fight, I'm sorry. There's not one dude that looked worse against Klitschko than Povetkin. He looked awful. He looked like a friggin' drunk Russian in that fight. Like, I think he lost, like, 119, 103, like, on all four cards, like, all three cards. Like, and if you look at Povetkin's record, all the dudes he fights are smaller dudes. Like, Wilder's like a 7-inch reach advantage on him. There's no way that he gets him.
Yeah, there's no mystery why Povetkin is fighting. So, well, actually, I guess he wants practice on Wack to get to Wilder. He knows Wack doesn't have the power. Well, listen, first time caller, thank you for calling in, Matt. It was a pleasure.
Hey guys.
It was a good call.
Hey, love the show. I'm always communicating with you guys on Twitter. Just hit me up sometime. I'm going to keep calling in from now on. I love the show, guys.
Yeah, keep calling in, man. That was a good call.
Hey, Matt.
Remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
All right, let me get to, we got 985. You're live. Who's this?
This is Big Bad Wolf from home in Louisiana. Yeah, y'all see I let Corey from West Virginia go first this time, right? I only card I watched this weekend was really the Wilder card, and I can't believe Mario was saying that Wilder isn't ready for the top fighters in the heavyweight division, yet Khan can destroy the world. I'm glad Manny Pacquiao is going to give him what he wants and put him to sleep. Yeah.
I'm desperate for that fight. I want it so bad.
I'm glad you're going to get it. You're going to watch.
We need that fight. Sleep. Big.
In that fight, I can't wait for Wilder to get his hands on Klitschko. I think he still got things to work on, but I think eventually, in the next year, so yeah, he'll beat Klitschko.
I think a caller, what's his name, made me believe more into Wilder. Now he makes me think that he could beat Cunningham, he could beat Fury, and he could put it on Klitschko. That's what I feel.
Yo, stay off the scissor. You're not even from Texas, and you sound like you're living over there with Mario.
No, I'm just trying to, get some rapport with the caller. That's all.
Rapport? Right, you sound like you're hitting on the caller, talking on the smooth and shit.
Pause.
Hey, Louisiana, man. Thank you for calling in. We're going to get into something
Louisiana.
Brand new this time around today. We're going to introduce a new little segment. So without further ado.
That was a hell of a handicapper. I can tell you that. I was so good that whenever I bet, I could change the odds for every bookmaker in the country.
All right, everybody. Welcome to Buying the Odds with Beeb. And first off, let me start by saying boxing, in my opinion, is the best sport in the world to bet on because no other sport in the world do the underdogs win more than in boxing. You're looking to make the most money in this sport. It's not about who gets the most picks right. It's about who gets the most value out of their picks. Because any idiot can pick the favorites. Who wants to bet $1,000 to win 100 when you can win 100 to make 1,000? So we're not just going to bet on winners and losers here, but we're going to bet on possible outcomes. We're going to bet on how the fight's going to play out, whether it's going to go the distance or not, and how many rounds it's going to go or not go. So today's fight that we're going to highlight and feature is Lucas Matisse versus Victor Postol. Now, Lucas Matisse is a minus 220 here, which means you have to bet $220 to make 100 on Lucas Matisse, while Victor Postol is a plus 180. So you only have to bet 100 to make 180 on Victor Postol. And remember, you get the amount you bet back as well as your winnings. Okay? So I like Postol big in this fight, and I'm going to tell you why. I think the odds makers got this one dead wrong, all right? I'm looking at this on paper as a 50-50 fight, even though the odds are telling us otherwise. So we're getting great value here, people, with Postol, and I'm advising everyone to jump on this one. I like Postol because I feel Matisse is primarily a mid-range fighter. He's the type of guy that needs to have his feet set in that mid-range area of the pocket to be effective. And guys who give him space and distance, like in his losses against Danny Garcia, Zab Judah, and Devin Alexander, those guys gave him space, and they were able to counter him, catching him on the way in while he was reaching in because of his short height and short reach. So even though I thought that he may have eked out decisions against Judah and Alexander. I still think they made him look vulnerable because they were able to be effective on the outside, and they were able to move, and they were able to kind of outslick him in certain spots of those fights. So, you know, even in his last fight against Ruslan Pavadnikov, Pavadnikov took that mid-range away from him too by smothering him on the inside and really working him up close chest to chest. Victor Postol, to me, is the direct opposite of Lucas Matisse. I think Victor Postol is effective at fighting at all ranges here. Even though he's 5'11 with a long reach, you know, he showed us that he could fight up close in his last fight against Selkirk Gaydon. You know, he caught him with some short uppercuts on the inside. He was very effective in that fight, you know. So even though Matisse may have the better resume here, I still think if you give Postol the eye test, he looks like the more versatile and more complete fighter here. And I think he has some quality wins over guys like, you know, DeMarcus Corley and Hank Lundy. So I think he's very live here. And it's not always about the resume, as I said. It's about the eye test. And I think that Postol will give Matisse trouble and keep him at bay with his height, reach, boxing ability, and movement in this fight. And I see him cruising to a unanimous decision in this one. So, guys, I'm rolling with Postol. I'm advising you two, too. And we're going to keep a running tally of the picks here. We're not going to worry about how many wins we get, how many losses we get. We're going to worry about how much money we're putting in the bank. Remember, guys, this is about value picks. It's about making money. It's not about coming on here bragging about how many picks we got right and who's going to eat crow and who's not going to eat crow. Because we want you to make money so you can take your girlfriend out to dinner, buy your kids some toys. We want you to put money in your pocket. We don't want you to have bragging rights to say, hey, I got 5 out of 6 right. Who cares if you got 5 out of 6 right if you're not making any money? Okay?
Hey, I like this segment, but I'm against Victor Postol.
It's a good segment. It's an awesome segment. So let me ask you, Beeb, are there any sites that you recommend in terms of you know, trusted sites that you get your money and everything
for betting? There's quite a few, and you can go to SBR, which is Sportsbook Rating, and they will tell you what the books are rated, whether they're rated A+, B+. My favorite site is fivedimes.com. I know a lot of you on Twitter have asked me about that, and I highly recommend that. Another great site is thegreek.com. I like Five Dimes because they have what's called reduced juice. So if a fight is a plus 180, come fight time, they'll give you a reduced juice option, and it could be a plus 190 or a plus 195. So they'll give you that option. They have the best lines. They have the best prop bets. They have the best you know, lines for over-unders. So I highly recommend fivedimes.com. And if anyone has any questions about how to sign up at fivedimes.com, tweet me, private, you know, DM me, and I can show you how to do that. You can set it up so you can get your payments directly to your bank account. So it's a great, great site, and I've always gotten paid out on that.
That's so dope.
Awesome.
I'm gonna look into that. But I'm still betting against Victor Postol.
I'm putting my money on Matisse. And you know what? You could put that 220 up. Well, we're only going to put 180 and 100, excuse me, and we're going to get that 180 back. So we're gonna double up almost.
That's awesome. And like I said, you know, or like Beeb said, this is a segment we're going to continue to do. You can hashtag us and at Beeb if there are any fights that you want mentioned on the segment. And we're going to continue to do this, and we're going to keep a running tally. We're going to keep a running tab, okay? Like Beeb said, this isn't, you know, in a month from now, it don't matter if you went 10 for 11 and, you know, you're riding around the same car. It matters if you went, you know, 1 for 5, but that one fight you won, you know, you got your money and it was a live dog and you're getting paid out. That's what matters right there. So just like you said, and we're going to continue to eat crow on Sundays. We're going to continue to make our picks. This is just a segment, you know, that separating from that. And so good job, Beef. Good job. I liked it a lot. It was great.
Excellent job.
Ness, you there, Ness?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask how often is Beating the Odds with Beeb going to be on?
I would like to do it once a week. And there are some cases where, you know, I could do it twice a week. But the thing here is we're looking for value. So this fight is the perfect fight for value because we're going to get almost 2-1 here. And this, you know, Postol is definitely a live dog. You know, so if, you know, the prime example here, I don't want to go off on a tangent, but, you know, I took Lamont Peterson over Amir Khan when Amir Khan was a 9-1 favorite. So I basically, you know, 9 times up my money. So I don't care if I lose my next 5 bets. I'm still in the black here. So this is, you know, what I want to show people here. And I want to at least do this segment once a week, if at all possible. And if you could fit into the itinerary, you know, and if you give me the platform and the time to do it, I would love to do it absolutely once a week. But the thing is I'm really looking for bettable fights, because some weeks we may not have bettable fights. And when I say value, there could be value the other way. If somebody we believe is a 9-1 favorite, but he's only listed as maybe a -150, that's still value, people, because, you know, the odds makers are getting it wrong once again, even though they're still... We're still in a deficit here. We still have to put up 150 to make 100. If we think it's a lock, it's still a good investment. If that guy should be a -5 or a -6, because they do it, you know, they could get it wrong sometimes on that end too.
Remember, hey, guys, during the segment, if you have any questions for Beeb that he can address either on the show live during his segment or for the next segment, # beating the odds with Beeb. Very simple. Kind of long.
We're behind the odds. Behind the odds would be, excuse me. But that's fine. My bad. That's fine. And guys, think of this as playing the stock market. This is simple and plain. This is stock market. You got a 401k. You're not looking at it every day. You're not trying to make $1 million every day. This is not a sprint. This is a marathon. And you could be wrong 60% of the time and still be putting money in your pocket. And this is what I try to explain people. Two people on here and they don't get it. So I've hit many 9-1s, 6-1s, 3-1s, 4-1s. So you may say, Beeb, you're getting it wrong. But when I get it right, baby, I make it count, and I want you to make it count too.
Mm. All right. So with that being said, we got to all our callers and we've touched on everything. I mean, we have a few headlines in case you guys still want to talk. I mean, Isaac Chalemba and Eldir Alvarez are to fight in November in a title eliminator in light heavyweight division. And obviously, we have a lot of upcoming fights. I mean, we can kind of preview the Tuesday PBC toe-to-toe.
Yeah, we should do that. We should do that.
Creeping up on us ever so quickly. They just happen. So much so that they're still asking for media credentials. I don't even know if people knew this was happening in Las Vegas. I believe at the Palms, Javier Fortuna, our last great Dominican hope, or one of them, because I'm hoping Felix Diaz could do something and surprise me against Lamont Peterson. But staying on topic, Javier Fortuna versus Carlos Velasquez in a 12-round junior lightweight title for the WBA regular title. So, I mean, I'm obviously going to go with Fortuna. You know, he's super wild, but I never even seen Carlos Velasquez outside of an interview done with one of our correspondents. I think it was actually Sean Zattel did some good stuff with Carlos Velasquez, Ivan Velasquez. And Dominic Dolton is on the undercard. I never even heard of him. Oscar Molina, I'm hoping that's the Molina that we all know, the brother of Carlos Molina. If not, I never heard of him. Jay Leon Love is fighting Udama, so I'm going to go with Jay Leon Love because Udama, I only heard of him for losing to Golovkin. Andrew Tabidi, a guy that we seen last time on PBC, first time on PBC. This is his second time back, hopefully, if he makes it to the live, you know, to the television. But I'm going to go with him. And Mickey Bay finally getting back in the ring. I'm going to go with him.
Yeah, I real quick, I do want to mention that Eldir Alvarez and Isaac Chalumba, that's a solid fight. Alvarez in his last... time in his last outing, I can't remember who he fought, but it was a entertaining bout, and that's the one thing about Alvarez is he is entertaining, and it's going to be a solid fight when it happens. But as far as the PBC, Fortuna Velasquez, this is a fight that is going so under the radar. I think the people need to be much more excited about this fight. It has the opportunity to be a great showdown. One of two things is going to happen. One, Fortuna is going to fight down to his opponent, and it's going to be an incredibly entertaining fight between two guys with opposing styles that is going to make for a great clash. Or the other thing that could happen is Javier Fortuna, you know, is and walks out that night to be the guy that I always thought he could be. And if that is the case, then he will dominate the fight. But he's going to do it in a really entertaining style because of the kind of clash that Velasquez is going to bring. It'll bring out the best in Fortuna. I really believe that his style is tailor-made for Fortuna, but with the way that Fortuna's looked in the last few fights, you know, there's no telling. And so I think that oftentimes he fights down to his opponent. And I agree with Ness on everything else. You know, Jay Leon Love, Mickey Bay, Andrew Tabai, you know, they're all solid fights. It should be a good card. I'm excited.
Beeb, you going to make your pick for Tuesday?
I'm going to take Fortuna.
PBRs, ladies and gentlemen, PBC, Fox Sports Deportes, and Fox Sports 1 on Tuesday. Beeb.
I'm rolling with Fortuna in this one. I still have faith in Fortuna. I know a lot of people think that he hasn't developed, but I still think he has the basic skills. I like his speed. I like his explosiveness. I like his athleticism. And if you give this guy the eye test, you could look at him and say maybe there's times when he's a little complacent, he should pour it on. But I think that, you know, he picks and chooses his spots, and I've seen him when he's on and when he's motivated. And I like this kid. I think he's going to be something special in the future. I like Fortuna.
Go for it.
I definitely am going to go with Fortuna. I think he'll do what he needs to do to retain his belt and hopefully move on to bigger and better fights.
Hey, listen, I wasn't even going to mention this because this is talk for Thursday's show, but I'm excited to see that Robert Easter Jr. is going to be taking on Miguel Acosta. Now, I know, Miguel Acosta, you know, when's the last time we've seen him versus Brandon Reels on Showtime? But so what? You got to think about Robert Easter and where he's at in his career. These are those type of fights where whoever was the guy that Marcus Brown just beat up Campillo. Those are those kind of fights. You're supposed to get rid of these veterans. You know what I'm saying? I'm excited to see that, man, because I don't know how long Robert Easter is going to be able to make that 135-pound limit. He's such a big, big kid. But, yeah, man, that's been the show. It was a great one. We want to thank everyone that participated and used the hashtag TBV podcast. Let's check it out, see if we got anything new before we go. We got one actually from Fahim. He says, I agree with Mario about Wilder, but he started in the game late, so he still thinks rather than react. Hashtag TBV podcast.
It's a good point. It's a good point. He's absolutely right. And that's kind of sad for me but it's kind of my bad that I didn't even, you know, mention that. And I never even considered that last night while watching the fight. Didn't consider that once during the broadcast until I read Fahim's tweet. And he's absolutely right. You got to always keep into account those things. And when you look at that aspect of it, I can see Wilder getting better. You know, I can't see him getting better. I really felt last night like this was the best of Wilder, and maybe he can, you know, get better depending on the opponent and the style matchup. But in terms of how long he's been fighting, Fahim's absolutely right. He can still get better.
I think he's the second best heavyweight in the world right now behind Tyson, the Truth Fury. And that could be the fight of the century. After Fury knocks out Vladimir Klitschko, probably tears his other calf in the process, I think that that's going to be a mega showdown that we could put it, you know where we could put it? Right in the Madison Square Garden. That would be theatrical. Right there, baby.
Definitely.
Enrique, you going to make some picks for Tuesday? Just Tuesday.
Oh, shit. I didn't even know there was a fight on Tuesday. Yeah, I was just saying, I don't even know the fighters, bro. Sorry. Definitely Saturday. I'm excited about that. You know, I'm casual, so I'm in the fence.
Just say Fortuna. Say Fortuna.
I mean, I was trying to Google Fortuna. I thought Fortuna was the guy that fought Chavez.
Beeble Fortuna. Beeble Fortuna.
No, that's Fonfora. That's Fonfora. You can get some good stuff on Fortuna. You can YouTube and get some good stuff on Fortuna.
Use Beeble. You don't need Google. I'll tell you.
So anyway, you know, from the foul line, I'll shoot and pick Fonfora.
It's not from Fora, bro.
Fortuna.
All right. Listen, what did I want to say? I wanted to say this. This is us officially abandoning the YouTube chat. We love you, but we got to let you go. We are no longer even giving out roll calls on there. So hashtag TBV podcast is the only way to interact and the only way to get a shout out. That being said, today's participants get their shout out. So on Twitter, at Fahim Sadiq, shout out to you. At Boxing Matt L. At JS Writing. At Bayamon Puerto Rico. I mean, Bayamon 93 PR. At Nicole. Oh, man, this is going to get bad. I'm going to have to go with your name and not your Twitter handle. At Michael Mojica. And obviously, Wassam. And Low Friend. I've never heard of that. Sam Gilly.
That's Scorsese, Low Friend.
Oh, yeah? He's yeah. so funny.
Why Michael that, like, Mojica, that's Fight that Source. That's Fight Source.
No, 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 but that's not – but, yeah, but this is another Mike – no, that's Matthew Mojica's Fight Source.
Matthew Mojica, my bad, my bad, my bad.
Jack Mercer, and that is about – oh, yeah, and Daniel K. and Tell J. 1. All right, and remember to bookmark the Amazon link if you're going to do any shopping, because it'll give us a little kickback.
Christmas time. Use it. Christmas time.
It costs you nothing. You know, it's your normal shopping. You know, your normal shopping. So that being said, oh, did I say Beast Mode? Shout out to Beast Modes on Twitter, because he also used the hashtag TBV podcast. Yeah.
Head over to the website too as well. We got great articles coming out every day, keeping y'all up to date. I promise you, you can go to TheBoxingVoice.com and you will be up to date on everything happening in boxing.
That's right, because if you go to the site, actually, there's a couple of good interviews with Austin Trout and Julian Williams. Then there's a confrontational interview. Josh Grafer
was cool.
on the scene in Pennsylvania, and he did some excellent work. He had some issues, so obviously the videos were posted a couple of days later, but he was exclusive. No one else was there, no other cameras. So the confrontation between Trout and Julian Williams, check it out on our YouTube channel
Passive
or on our videos page on the boxingvoice.com. You could just go there, and they're there. Search it under a tag or whatever. Beep.
Yes, and also don't forget to download the Boxing Voice app on Google Play and iTunes. Please do that, because if you want to check out articles as well as listen to the podcast, as well as check out the Twitter, the Facebook, you have it all
at your
disposal. And the store as well. Great point. You have it all at your disposal at one little flick of your finger. Boop, and you get it all right in front of your face.
Yeah, and we want to say last month there was like 44 people, right? Or 84?
44 people on 45 people on iTunes alone. So just tell a friend to tell a friend. Get the word out there, because – you know, you could listen to the podcast. While you're listening to the podcast, you could buy something on the store. After you buy something in the store, you could check out, hey, what's Ness doing on Twitter? What's Boxing Voice doing on Twitter? So there's just, everything just flows into, you know, everything. So it's just like, you don't have to sit there and keep opening windows. You just, the app is right there. Everything is there in front of your face.
And I just want to remind everyone again about these David Lemieux tickets for the email subscription. All you got to do is head on over to TheBoxingVoice.com. Just sign up to be on our email subscription list. And you get these two free tickets to Madison Square Garden for David Lemieux and Gennady Golovkin live on pay-per-view October 17th. And I want to say thank you. Thank you, because there is 13,000 of you that signed up to the email list. So that's fucking insane.
Awesome.
This non-influential podcast, man. Fuck, how did they get 13,000 people to sign up? We're so fucking non-influential. We do nothing over here. Listen.
It's good to suck and win.
I know. This is what losing feels like. Fuck me.
Oh, my God.
That being said, Ray Donovan tonight, people. Later. Good night.
Peace.
Peace.
Peace out.
Thank you for